Playoffs on NESN. Come your way live from TD Garden in Boston. And so it comes down to this in the Eastern Conference quarterfinal series between the fourth-seeded Boston Bruins and the fifth-seeded Toronto Maple Leafs. Game 7, deadlocked at 3 wins apiece. The winner advances. The loser is done. And hello again, everybody. High above the ice alongside Andy Brickley with Naoko Funayama at ice level. I'm Jack Edwards. Brick, what are they made of? The Boston Bruins will have the glow of the 2000 Stanley Cup upon them as long as one of those cup winners still skates in black and gold. But they also live under the shadow of a horrible collapse against the Philadelphia Flyers and a very disappointing Game 7 loss against the Washington Caps that were bookends on that year of glory.
Well, the only pressure is the pressure the players put on themselves to perform. You know, they've learned how to win in these situations, both from failing in Game 7s and being victorious. They should embrace where they are right now. They've worked hard, they've prepared, they've sacrificed. This is where you want to be in the moment right now.
And perhaps on a twist on what Claude Julien said after a disappointing Game 6 loss last night in Toronto, they need to embrace the Jekyll and Hyde aspects of their personalities, because for every Jekyll, the responsible player who does all the right things within the system, there has to be a little Hyde, doesn't there? There has to be that sense of, I have a bigger will to win than that guy on the other side of the puck.
Exactly right. And that's how it's manifested, that split personality, is that will to win. You got to win every puck battle. You got to really break the game down shift by shift. If you're a leader of your team, then you lead the right way. If you're a guy that's looked upon to be an offensive spark, make the plays that you're expected to make. If you're a three-zone guy, be the best three-zone guy you could possibly be. And if you're an energy, bring that energy as well. And that's what the Boston Bruins are made up of. That's when they play their best, when they play as a full team, when they roll their four lines, and they have to have the believability themselves that Toronto has shown that they have in this series.
I think it was the just-retired legendary BU coach Jack Parker who said, they got the wrong name for the game. It ought to be called goalie. Well, in the playoffs, sometimes it might as well be.
Well, the questions were there at the beginning of the playoffs for both teams. For Toronto, did James Reimer have enough to be a guy that could be a goaltender that could make a difference for an underdog team in round one? For the Bruins, Tuukka Rask, could he lead the Bruins to a long playoff run? He certainly answered a lot of questions during the regular season, but Reimer, to our surprise, and I think to the NHL hockey community's surprise, maybe not to the Leafs, how good was he in games 5 and 6 on the brink of elimination? He brought his game. Yes, there were a lot of rebounds, and maybe he looked a little awkward at times, but he did what he's supposed to do, and that's keep the puck out of the net. He allowed the Leafs to push this series to Game 7. Tuukka Rask, as advertised, Jack, this guy is just pretty calm back there. He has so much faith in his own skills and his own talents. He wanted to prove to his team, his organization, the fans, that he was up for the challenge this year, replacing Tim Thomas. Got the job done in the regular season. His numbers were top 5 in the most important categories, and he's been right there again in the postseason sending that message. I'll give you an opportunity to win every night. We just got to find a more creative and more productive offense.
This series and this season will turn on a single moment sometime in the next 2.5 or maybe 3 or 4 hours. Stay with us. Game 7, always one for the books. We're back in a flash. All right.
With glowing heart.
team has been down 3-1 in a best-of-seven series and has forced a seventh game. Those teams that have won games 5 and 6 are 24-23, so they're on the odd game. Tonight's starting goalies brought to you by Hess and Hess Express. First time James Reimer's been in a Stanley Cup playoff series, so it is also his first Game 7. Tuukka Rask's only other Game 7 appearance was 3 years ago tomorrow against the Philadelphia Flyers. It has been an albatross around Rask's neck, and he would love to leave it behind. Interesting to note that Zdeno Chara is not on the ice for the opening faceoff. It's Seidenberg and Dougie Hamilton, as Phil Kessel's not out there. A rare occurrence when Chara doesn't start the game. The game is on. It's Game 7. It's all about the moment, Brick.
And for the Boston Bruins, it's all about taking care of the puck, an area that Claude Julien talked about that was not there in their most recent game, the Game 6 loss in Toronto. Take care of the puck. Don't turn it over. Minimize it.
Lucic, the tip pass to Krejci. It's a 2-on-1 with Horton against Gardner. The shot saved, rebound saved by Reimer. And Krejci almost tucked it in next to the post. Seidenberg steps up and puts the bump on Matt Fratton. Here comes Lucic, turning with speed right back over the line. Van Riemsdyk knocks the puck loose. Cody Franzen back of his own goal. Franzen around the boards. Jágr knocks it down. Krejci comes out of the corner. Lucic in front for Jágr. The little tip, and it rolls up over the knee pads and settles along the pants of James Reimer.
Well, we talked a lot about the Bruins and their need to finish. Nice handle of the pinch by Lucic. Good support by Krejci. Glad to see Krejci shoot that puck in the 2-on-1 early in the hockey game. You want to challenge Reimer. And then Lucic gets open in that high slot. Jágr's wide open, uncovered, going to the net, but he can't handle the pass from Lucic. Hops up on the blade of his stick, gets away from him. Two real good opportunities in the first 45 seconds of the game.
Bergeron, Jágr, and Marchand. So Jaromir Jágr skating where Tyler Seguin normally has been, and Seguin took the 3-on-2s with the Bergeron line, but it is Jágr. Jágr off the stick of Grabowski. Marchand hustles to the puck. Bergeron to the front of the goal. It's loose in the crease. Still loose. The Leafs clear to the blue line, but not out. Boychuk slides it over to Matt Barkowski, who is a late addition with Wade Redden being a last-second scratch. Bergeron whips it right on goal, and Reimer has to make the stop on the shot from behind the goal line. Kuhlman chips the puck into the corner. Bergeron back after it. Hammers it around the boards. Marchand lets it come to him, but it goes past. John Michael Lyles up to Clark MacArthur, back to Lyles. Deafening Let's Go Bruins chant at TD Garden. Chara, Kelly back into the attacking zone. Kelly with Seguin on one wing and Beverly on the other. Nazem Kadri intercepted. Seguin throws it into the slot. Ryan O'Byrne takes it away to John Michael Lyles. Kelly finishes his check on Lyles. Penalty coming up against Boston here. Reimer takes his time to get to the Toronto bench. Kadri taking a poke at Beverly in the neutral zone. They're both going to go.
Now, Beverly was trying to get Kadri to engage in the neutral zone while Toronto had possession of the puck on the delayed penalty. We'll see if he did enough to get Kadri to make this an even up, or if Toronto will end up with a power play.
So Kadri gets 2 minutes for holding. Beverly gets a roughing, and somebody gets tripping. I'm not sure if it was Beverly.
Yeah, Beverly gets the extra two, Jack. Toronto will go on the power play. This is what I was concerned about. Beverly had the initial penalty for the trip, and then he tried to engage Kadri in order to even it up as best he could. You don't want to put your team down, especially the way you've started this hockey game. You've been in Toronto's end the entire time. But similar to Game 5, an early power play opportunity for the Leafs when Boston had early momentum.
Franzen, Phaneuf, Kessel, Van Riemsdyk, and Lupo. Leafs were 0-for-1 last night, 4-for-18 in the series on the power play. Van Riemsdyk, Horton, Boychuk side of the ice. Chara buries Kessel. They both go down in the corner. The puck swings all the way back to Phaneuf. Phaneuf slips to Kessel. Chara active against him, and he clears it past.
And a good read by Jara. One of the big hit on Kessel, but he wasn't balanced enough to really deliver a hurtful blow. But then a good read to follow Kessel up close to the blue line.
Van Riemsdyk takes foot up speed, sends it through the corner. Jara winds up, drives it all the way back. Franzen snaps it along the line for the angles. Bergeron. Lopel in the corner brings it back to Van Riemsdyk along the line to Franzen. Back to Phaneuf. The touch pass for Kessel with Van Riemsdyk in front. Kessel off of Boychuk's legs. Kessel tries to throw it to the post. Van Riemsdyk jams. Rask paddles it out of there. Here's Lopel with the turnaround drive. Loose in front. Bergeron finds the puck and fires it out. Van Riemsdyk wrestling with Char in the Boston end, and Char just dumps him. The crowd is delirious. Chara just leveraged him. His father was an Olympic wrestler for Czechoslovakia before it split into two countries, and that was an Olympian move. Grabowski takes a huge hit from Kelly to move it into the zone. Lyles to Gardner. Lyles, the drive, trickles past the post. Grabowski hops on the loose puck. Pye and McQuaid, back of the goal line for Boston. Lyles pulls it off the boards, gives to MacArthur. Three shots during the power play. Thornton is the extra man coming back on. Pullen brings it back to Lyles, settles the puck to drive. Grabowski with a tip, and it goes into the protective netting, and the crowd chants Tuukka.
I think this faceoff is going to come out of the neutral zone on the redirect of the shot from the point. Good body contact. Starts with Chara killing the penalty. No reason you can't be aggressive at the right times when you're shorthanded. Don't take yourself out of position to go for the big hit. Chara delivers good contact on Kessel. And I love the fact, as did Žužek, that they let this kind of activity go. And Riemsdyk works the front of the net. He sticks his nose in there, so to speak. And if they're going to let what an area that you should have to fight for, if they're going to let that good physical hard play go all night in a game seven, I think it's the right decision.
Bruins fans will be forgiven if they suffered a flashback there with James Van Riemsdyk on the stick side post of Tuukka Rask. It was from nearly that very spot 3 years ago tomorrow that he started the Flyers' comeback from 0-3 down in game seven. After a tremendous check by Mike Richards on the end boards. Now here comes Colton Orr, the shot stick saved by Rask. Hits the high glass and then deflects out over the low glass. The faceoff will be in the Bruins zone.
And this is where it's important for Boston now to have a couple of good shifts. You had it rolling early. You had a couple of real good looks. The two-on-one with Krejci. The Jágr opportunity right at the top of the crease. And then the Leafs get that power play to kind of turn the momentum. The momentum swings. And it swings fast in playoff games, and especially in game sevens when you have two fairly evenly matched teams. So important for Boston to get a couple of good shifts in a row here.
Rick, you mentioned the parallel to game five. That was a penalty against Kelly at 1:46 after the Bruins had gotten off to a terrific start. And Toronto found its attacking rhythm for the rest of the period. Bergeron tries to butt it over the shoulder of Reimer. Bergeron intercepts the pass, swivels it top of the circle, but Fratton is there in front of Barkowski. He hoists it for Lupo. But Boychuk has a step on Lupel, turns in front of Rask, goes long diagonal indirect looking for Marchand, and Phaneuf makes a saving tap into the Toronto bench because Marchand was gone behind him.
Well, both teams trying to stretch the neutral zone a little bit. It started with a high backhand lob looking for Lupel by Fratton. Nice decision by Marchand in on the forecheck, the fake contact, jump into the passing lane, make the steal. Short side play to Bergeron. Bergeron trying to bat one out of midair, short side. Reimer was off the post a bit. And then when Toronto got the steal on the pass out front, they tried that high lob in behind the Bruin defense, but Johnny Boychuk with a good read. And then Boychuk tried the lengthy pass himself to Marchand, trying to get in behind Dion Phaneuf.
Krejci wins the faceoff against Joe Colborne, who shifts out immediately, and Mikhail Grabowski comes onto the ice. Barkowski gives it ahead for Krejci. Krejci to Horton, wing to wing. Boychuk there, wires it into the zone. Let's go Bruins, the chant from the crowd. The puck pops up to the circle. MacArthur gloves it down. Lucic lines up Franzen, and he backs away from the puck. Franzen hoists it up and not out. Horton to Lucic. Lucic takes the hit. Franzen seals him off. Franzen through the legs, gives it away to Bartkowski. He scores! Mac Bartkowski makes it 1-0 Boston. Lucic's influence helps Franzen have a vapor lock.
Well, so many things I like about this goal. It's the forecheck. Toronto has possession. They try to go D to D behind the net. When that doesn't connect, Lucic comes in looking for the big hit. Franzen avoids the body contact. Now they think they're okay because Franzen gets the puck again. But because of the threat of the big hit, the pressure you put on defense by Lucic with his straight-ahead speed and his willingness to take the body, creates the turnover. Bartkowski's in a good position, and before that, Jack, was Horton rotating out to that left point. Kept the play in the offensive zone, and then David Krejci gets to the front of the net on the wrist shot by Bartkowski.
The Garden delirious. Fedoff gives it away at his own line to Jágr. Puck management, a huge factor. Brick's been talking about it for a week. Chara knocks the puck loose. Jágr and Kessel. Jágr wins the puck battle. Fedoff slams hard into Marchand. Jágr tries to push it to Bergeron in the corner. Jágr kicks to the stick. Jágr comes up to the half boards, indirect to Chara. Chara down the wall for Bergeron. He backhands it for Marchand, dragging it around Fedoff on the perimeter. Marchand cuts to the middle. Fedoff body checks him, and here comes Van Riemsdyk off Kessel's touch pass. Van Riemsdyk goes to the corner, skates past the puck, and Chara tries to staple it in. Orr comes through to bang Chara. Orr just punching away at Chara's chest. Hamilton up for Sagan in the center circle. Hamilton bounces it ahead for Paille. He works against Lyles. Paille, the shift onto the backhand, goes to the corner. Colton Orr against Sagan. Bartkowski blocks the puck in deep. O'Byrne seals off Sagan. Orr around behind his own net. McClement waiting. McQuaid pinches in, knocks him away, throws it in front. Only Ryan O'Byrne there. O'Byrne skates it free of his own zone. Van Riemsdyk wires it around through the corner. Rask knocks it down for Bartkowski. Bartkowski hard off the boards. It bounces off Franzen's stick and Gardner collects.
Yeah, I like that by Bartkowski. Not going to waste any time in his own zone. Unfortunately, the Bruins were changing out left wings, so there was no receiver to handle that pass, but the quick up was good.
Reimer, the chant. The leather lungs have brought him tonight. They are making a ton of noise at TD Garden. Matt Fratton into the center circle. Chara with the radar sweep. Lupul gets past. He goes in and a save by Rask. Tuukka Rask with a marvelous right leg save. The Bruins are going to be penalized here.
It's going to be Chara.
High sticking, I believe, is the call. They'll look at Lupul to see if he's injured. Matt Bartkowski has the Bruins on top. And across Causeway Street at the Fours Restaurant, they're raising the roof.
Zdeno Chara in the box for a high stick. Nice pass by Matt Fratton. Gets it in behind Johnny Boychuk. And even though this is a good bounce because it was a good poke check by Zdeno Chara, deflected up off Lupul. It allowed him to skate right back in. We're trying to go to the backhand. Tuukka Rask stays with him beautifully. Extends that right pad to keep this a 1-0 lead for Boston. But you saw the stick work by Chara right up a little high. That's why he's in the box. One of your prime penalty killers. Second power play for the Leafs.
Off the faceoff, it goes right on Rask. Franzen down to the corner. Peverly knocks it loose to Boychuk. And he backhands it all the way down to the Leafs end. Chara has more shorthanded time on ice than any member of the Boston Bruins. Crucial to the penalty kill. Rask leaves the puck for Bartkowski, wraps it around, it bounces to Franzen, facing Bergeron, he throws it in deep. Boychuk to Bartkowski, finds some space and banks it hard off the boards past Franzen.
Yeah, second chance, he got himself turned a little better to get that puck hard off the glass and out. First attempt that was set up for Rask. He had a little more time than he thought did Bartkowski.
Campbell delayed Fedoff behind the Toronto goal. Here comes Kessel flying over the line, working on McQuaid. Pulls up at the half boards, brings it back to Fedoff. Lupul sets up in front, now comes to the weak side circle. Hamilton blocks Franzen's shot. Paille hammers it, and Franzen knocks it down, but can't keep it in the zone.
That's where you need communication. Hamilton has to be yelling at Paille, you have time.
Franzen carries over the line. Van Riemsdyk hard around. Rask slows it down, but Leupel's on the puck against McQuaid. Can't control. McQuaid tries to pin it into the boards to bleed the clock. Hamilton bumps Van Riemsdyk. Seven players, he could throw a blanket over him in the corner. Here's Van Riemsdyk taking the whack from Hamilton. Shoves it past Kessel to Phaneuf. Campbell closing down space on Phaneuf. Kessel at the dot, brings it cross ice. Franzen gets Paille down, closes for Kessel. Wanted to shuttle it, now gives it back to Phaneuf. Phaneuf to Kessel, he holds with McQuaid down on a knee. Too hard cross ice for Franzen. Franzen recovers with a big reach before Paille could get there. Van Riemsdyk back of the goal. Leupel in the corner, back to Kessel, has Phaneuf at the point. The one-timer saved by Rask, rebound, whacked away, it scores! Cody Franzen wraps home the rebound from the crease with 6 seconds to go on the power play. And they're going nuts in Maple Leaf Square.
Well, the Bruins just could not corral this puck after the initial stop by Rask. The good hard one-timer from Kessel to Phaneuf gets knocked down in front. Van Riemsdyk keeps it alive. Hamilton can't locate it. McQuaid can't find it or can't get to it. And Franzen, who always moves in off that weak side. Kessel tried to find him earlier in a nice rotation. Pass was just a little forward of Franzen, but Franzen hangs around that weak side post. And all he's got to do is get to that puck first and slide it into an empty net on the back end.
What sweet redemption for Cody Franzen, who felt the pressure from Milan Lucic and turned it over to Matt Barkowski for the first goal of the game. He gets the one that ties it up on the power play. Chara, who was in the box, sends it up to Nathan Horton. Toronto has 9 shots on goal in the game. 7 have come on the power play. Clark MacArthur taking the stretch pass, turning against Nathan Horton, goes to the slot. Kuhlman shot, kick, saved by Rask. Tuukka Rask has had 2 brilliant right pad saves already in this game. Lucic from Chara into Fratton, skates and wiggles all the way through. Krejci swipes it through to Horton. Horton across the middle. Gunnarsson taps it off the end glass. Lucic flying through the corner, reverses past Horton. Krejci and Gardner in the right wing corner now. Krejci reverses it. Gunnarsson goes down in contact with Horton. Barkowski to Horton, comes out the half boards, the shot into a pair of legs. Barkowski sprays it to space behind Lucic. Krejci. Gardner checks him. Grabowski slides it up to Fratton. Fratton tries the self-pass. Barkowski with a quick turn and recovery. Fratton keeps moving. He's got Grabowski middle looking for Leupel, but he sends it behind him. Sagan in transition for Kelly. Sagan going to goal. Kelly couldn't get it across to Peverly. He gets hammered, and now Fratton flying through goes over Kelly. Here comes Leupel in transition with Joe Colborn going to the middle. Colborn back of the net against Chara. Colborn keeps his legs moving, takes the hit from Kelly. Chara gets hammered by Orr, who knocks him down. Orr came an awful long way for that hit on Chara. John Michael Lyles at his own line. Colborn sprinting to the corner. Barkowski goes shoulder to shoulder with him. Colborn keeps the puck, centering pass. Hamilton tips it away as Komarov was looking to come into the weak side. Komarov tries to tip it in front of the goal. Wins the puck battle with Hamilton. Squirts it toward the post. Kelly knocks it down off Barkowski's deflection. Tyler Sagan, full throttle, gets over the red line and sends it in toward Reimer. Peels off for a change.
Yeah, just a little too late in the shift to get anything going. What speed to the outside?
Lyles taps it forward for Colton Orr. Ahead to Nazem Kadri. Kadri cuts to the inside. The shot saved by Raskin off the apron of the net. Marchand takes a hit from Van Riemsdyk to move it to Bergeron to Jágr. Kessel pokes it away, gives to Van Riemsdyk. Past Kadri up the left wing. Boychuk back after it. Over to Chara. Breakneck pace at TD Garden here. And then they go. Bergeron has Jágr on his right. Jágr cuts to the middle. Jágr's shot saved by Reimer. There is no rebound. 7:37 to go, first period. And yeah, it's taken off like a jet. 1-1 in game 7 with the Bees and the Leafs. The twisted but true fact of the game. Both goalies have been excellent in this series. Tuukka Rask, James Reimer. The save percentages coming into tonight, identical at 9.32. Twisted Tea hard iced tea, the refreshing hard iced tea that tastes like real iced tea. Be a little twisted. Campbell Thornton, Pye, McQuaid, and Bartkowski for the Bruins. McClement, Grabowski, Kuhlman, Phaneuf, and Gunnarsson for the Leafs. Bartkowski pitches up. McClement rushes into the neutral zone. McClement going down McQuaid's side. McQuaid angles into the boards. Thornton takes the puck. Let's go, Bruins, the chant from the crowd. Thornton knocked down on Komarov's check. Gets some help from McQuaid. Bounces it up middle of the zone. Pye on the receiving end of a huge hit from Colton Orr that knocks Pye's stick all the way over in front of the Boston bench. Campbell collides with Reimer as he was tied up with O'Byrne. Tremendously physical play in the first half of this first period. Chara, Thornton takes the bump from O'Byrne and tips the puck deep. Campbell chasing against Lyles. Straight ahead for McClement. McClement has Fratton on the right side, dribbles it toward the corner. Rask flips past Fratton. Lucic saucers it. It rolls for Krejci. He's got Horton on the left. Lucic the trailer. Horton's shot into the skates of Phaneuf. Lucic off Phaneuf's skates. It bounces back to Bartkowski, the Bruins goal scorer. Off the corner boards, it comes cleanly to Lucic. Back to Boychuk, the drive. Krejci on the doorstep tip. Bartkowski fakes the shot, takes a hit from Fratton. Lupel picks up the puck in the corner. Joffrey Lupel lifts it out to the blue line. Horton gets knocked into the neutral zone by Colborne. And here comes Lupel working against Bartkowski, who mashes him on the boards. Puck loose, here's Colborne, the shot, saved by Rask. Joe Colborne finding the loose puck and attacking with speed through the seam.
Oh no, he got a pass. That was an unbelievable play by Lupel. Certainly to my eyes, he was able, after he got plastered in the boards, to get his stick on it to find Colborne.
Gardner with Kessel, Gardner's shot goes wide. Marchand in front of Kadri. Kadri recovers the puck and brings it back to Franzen. Cross ice, Gardner, back to Franzen. Jake Gardner indirect, Van Riemsdyk loops it into the corner. Boychuk turns the Boston goal, chips off the boards. Van Riemsdyk comes flying through, runs himself into the boards after he takes out Bergeron. Gardner back of his net, take the tape to Kadri. Van Riemsdyk pivots the puck past McQuaid. Kessel's shot goes over the top, hits glass. Funky bounce comes right to Gardner. Cross ice for Lyles. He's got a little space. Rips it through the corner. It hops over Kadri's backhand. Chara draws MacArthur, trickles it to Marchand. Back to Chara. Cross ice for McQuaid. Five to go in the first in a 1-1 game. Game seven, the Keys and the Leafs. Rich Peverly, the shot goes well wide on the glove side. Nikolai Kuhlman up to the Boston line with McClement middle. Rask makes the glove stop and he'll take the faceoff. Joe Colborne, once a first-round draft choice of the Boston Bruins. And he comes onto the puck and flips it on Rask. Denied. The Geico quote of the day. Earlier today, Chris Kelly. You can go back and analyze every game, but it's just about one game, and winner takes all. Sporting stitches he picked up in this series. Chris Kelly, when he had his face slammed into the post in 2011, asked if there was anything broken in his face, said, "I'm okay." How's that for a non-answer answer? Johnny Boychuk up to the line. Second effort gets it out. Tyler Seguin has Kelly ahead. Kelly goes to the corner against O'Byrne. Kelly takes O'Byrne to the end boards. The puck loose. Kadri fighting Seguin for the puck. Peverly in support. Swipes it around. Kessel up but not out. Boychuk wrists it down to the end boards. It bounces off the wall. And Reimer clamps down on it to take the faceoff with 4:15 to go in the first. Staying out of the box is key for the Bruins. The Leafs
have had more than half of their 12 shots on goal on the power play and their only goal of the game. Jágr tries to spin it past Gunnarsson. Gunnarsson sends it to his D pair, Fanouf. The backhand off the glass. Chara flips it ahead. It comes right to Kuhlman. Kuhlman leaves the puck behind just outside the line. MacArthur recovers back to Gunnarsson. Jake Gardner, who has raised a lot of eyebrows for those who were not familiar with his skating ability. Ryan Burke drafted him in Anaheim and then traded for him in Toronto. And now everybody knows why. Bergeron with the steal. Gardner takes it back over to Franzen, ahead to Kuhlman, and the huge triangles forming for Toronto. Hamilton gives the shoulder to Clark MacArthur and then takes the puck forward. Goes indirect, but it's too far forward for Lucic. Fratton back to Gunnarsson. Rick, you've been talking about puck management and decision making in a 1-1 game late in the first. It's at a premium right now.
Yeah, for the most part, both teams have been pretty good. They've been victimized a little bit by turnovers that have created opportunities, but overall, in the scheme of things here in Game 7, both trying to really win that battle of puck possession, especially in center ice.
Lupo flying to the corner against Barkowski. He reads it hard into Colborne's skate, so he couldn't control it. It's a 3-on-2 for Boston. Horton to Krejci with Lucic going on the diagonal. It's Horton in front. Couldn't settle the puck with Colborne on his back. Lucic wrestles himself free from Gunnarsson. Tries to wheel it middle. Gunnarsson takes him to the boards. Lucic just throws him off his skates. Horton down the wall to Lucic. He A-frames and sticks his butt out so Colborne can't shut down space. Then Lucic gives it away. Kessel hard onto the backhand for Lupo. Lupo waits for fresh line mates. Throws the backhand through the goal mouth. Nobody home. Haye takes it down to the corner. Chara pokes it ahead. Fratton shields the puck but then gives it away in the corner to Chara. Boychuk off the high glass and it bounces out of play. The faceoff will be in the Boston zone with 2:11 to go in the first.
Join the Bruins and Pro Ambitions for the Yo Kids Bruins Summer Camp presented by Stonyfield Farms. Kids ages 6 to 15 will sharpen their game with skills and drills taught by members of the Bruins organization and Pro Ambitions team. Act now to reserve a spot by visiting bostonbruins.com. Limited spots remain.
McClement wins the faceoff to the boards. Leo Komarov turns it toward the middle, but Bergeron takes the puck away. Paye snaps it past to Campbell, but Orr knocks him off it. Bergeron changes out for Thornton. McClement chips the puck past McQuaid to the corner. Paye back after it, around all the way to Thornton. Thornton, a high backhand pass, wing to wing to Campbell, turns and slams it, but misses the puck and hits Gardner with his stick. McClement shoves the puck into the skates. Gardner chips it right into Campbell's belly. Paye on the end boards gets upended as he was trying to win the puck from McClement. McClement up the boards and it bounces past Thornton and Hamilton to center. Barkowski with a quick couple of steps to change the point of attack. Wrists it through the corner. Reimer stops it for Gardner. He gives it up where Thornton is in the corner. Thornton against Franzen. Thornton pulls the puck loose. Zips it back to Chara along the line to Hamilton against Komarov. Hamilton hesitates. Wrists it through the corner. Kelly slows it down. McClement engaged down there with Peverly. Peverly tries to rip it out of McClement's skates and does. Franzen attacks Peverly, but he gets it back to Chara. Final minute of the first period. Chara wrists it through the middle. Kelly couldn't make the adjustment as he was in a wrestling match in front. Now Nikolai Kuhlman gives back to Cody Franzen. Franzen D to D to Gardner. Gardner the diagonal. MacArthur moving his feet but leaving the puck behind. Kelly can't get it out of the zone. Grabowski closes. Fires way wide. It's off the corner boards. MacArthur back in the Boston net. Boychuk one against two. Patient D to D pass to Chara. Chips it up the boards. Sagan waiting up high in the zone where the Bruins wings play in the D zone. Peverly cross ice to Sagan. He makes sure he gets to the red line and flips it in. 15 seconds to go in the period. Dion Fanouf trying to get away from Brad Marchand, who chops down on his stick. Bergeron the steal. A hard pass, but Jágr couldn't field it. Bergeron had to get something on it because he didn't want it to land on a Leaf stick. Just couldn't connect with Jaromir Jágr. The siren sounds. 20. high tempo minutes gone. It's 1-1 in game seven.
Bruins keep that first period at even strength, 5-on-5. You got to like their chances of having a lead at the end of 20 minutes, but no surprise. When you try to figure out what was going to happen tonight coming into game seven between these two teams, I think 1-1 after one was somewhat predictable.
Well, in this series, Dale, as Brick said, the Bruins have been better 5-on-5. They've outscored Toronto 13-9 in that manpower situation. And on the power play, Toronto has 5 power play goals to 3 for the Bruins, so they are playing right to form. This is an unbelievable game seven.
Jack, you guys hit the nail on the head. This, if you take away the 2 power play opportunities for the Toronto Maple Leafs, and I'm not suggesting you should or could, this Bruins have a pretty good situation going in this one. Welcome back to the TD Garden. Dale Arnold, Barry Peterson, Gord Kluzak. All in all, as those guys said, about what we expected here in the first.
Yeah, it really was. We know it's a Game 7 atmosphere. Right now, we're going to be a little concerned about Seidenberg's situation. We only played 37 seconds, so that's going to be a big look at for him, make sure he's not too hurt. But it was a good physical period.
It was, but I mean, no Seidenberg, no Ferentz, no Redden. That starts to be a big, big factor that we're going to have to keep an eye on here.
Well, let's start things off with the physical play. As you expected, it was going to be a physical game seven, and there have been some thunderous hits out there.
Yeah, they really have from both sides. Chara taking a run there. The Leafs also, they came to play. Good hit there on Grabowski at the neutral zone by Kelly. Here we've got Van Riemsdyk and Chara going at it. The Bruins got to be careful because Toronto right now is a mark, or Chara is a marked man, especially with Seidenberg. Seidenberg, Ferentz, and Redden. Now Toronto consents it, so they're going to be going after Chara. The Bruins got to keep their cool and make this a 5-on-5 hockey game.
I'll say this. James Van Riemsdyk has been whining for calls for about the last 4 games. Not surprising you saw him with his hands up in the air there. Then the Bruins got exactly what they wanted. Matt Bartkowski playing. Got an opportunity. As we'll show you on the Amica coverage cam, it's not just how you're covered, Gordy, it's how you're treated.
Yeah, some good work here by the Bruins. Along the boards, Bartkowski pinching in. Bruin Horton backing him up. Milan Lucic, good work along the boards. And Franson gives that behind-the-back blind pass right to Bartkowski. He waits for Krejci to get to the front of the net, and he finds that short side. But a very, very calm, nice play and great finish by Bartkowski.
The Toronto Maple Leafs have obviously targeted Zdeno Chara in the first period. Not a bad strategy if you can pull it off. The result was a Chara high sticking penalty that led to a power play opportunity for the Leafs.
Yeah, Lupo gets a step here on the outside right here. He's flying through the neutral zone. A little high stick right there, and what a save, pad save by Tuukka Rask. Unbelievable. Bruins had the puck right here. You're shorthanded. You've got to get that puck all the way down. You don't. That allows Toronto to regroup and come and counter back in. They move it back around to the point. You're going to see Kessel over here back to Phaneuf. He one times it. Van Riemsdyk like he has been all series in front of the net. And there's Bronson coming back to door. His second. That ties it up 1-1 on the power play, but a good one-timer there by Phaneuf. Van Riemsdyk in front, and here comes backdoor Franson just jumping in.
Hamilton and McQuaid, 2 right-handed defensemen. I guarantee they haven't killed a penalty together all year. That's the type of situation the Bruins are in right now with all the injuries on the blue line.
Well, let's get to that point. The Bruins started tonight's game without Andrew Ferentz and without Wade Redden. Redden, quite honestly, surprised most of us. And then Dennis Seidenberg lasted only 37 seconds into the first period.
We'll see him along here, see what happens. I could see him on the bench sort of rubbing his leg, and they could see maybe he caught his right knee there. I'm not sure, but what a devastating loss it is if Dennis Seidenberg is unable to go.
Yeah, because to your example of the right-handed shots, now that only leaves Char and Bartkowski on the left side, that means you're going to be rotating those two guys through and probably having to move somebody from the right side over to the left, and they're not comfortable over there.
Well, I can promise you they're already playing Bartkowski and Hamilton more minutes than they plan to in this game. 1-1 is our score at the end of the first 20 minutes of play. Shots on goal favored the Leafs 12-7. Remember, they had the only 2 power play opportunities. Bruins win in the faceoff circle as they have most of the series, and the scoring chances favor the Leafs as well, 7-3. The Bruins got on the board first, an unassisted goal for Matt Bartkowski, his first of the playoffs, then the power play goal from Cody Franson, from Van Riemsdyk and Phaneuf. That's the way things stand, 1-1 at the end of the first 20 minutes of play. When we come back, we'll preview Game 7, the other Game 7 going on tonight between the Rangers and the Capitals.
The stage. The dream. A difference between game on and go home.
And the Bruins showing hearts of lions.
The quest for the cup on Nesset, presented by Xfinity.
Stay tuned after the game for extended Bruins coverage on Ace Ticket Bruins Overtime Live and Nesson Daily live from our Garden Studio with Barry and Gordy. Bruins and Leafs tied 1-1 at the end of one period of play. After the period, Milan Lucic with Nauko Funayama.
Milan, we often hear you say when the forecheck goes, the team is going. How is that first goal a function of the Bruins forecheck working?
Yeah, just getting on pucks, and you know, it's been a long series so far, so you got to think that some of them are bruised up, so you got to keep the pressure on them. And great job by Bart stepping up there and getting off a great shot on net to get the first goal of the game.
Kind of a heavyweight battle out there, both sides trying to establish the physicality early.
Yeah, definitely. It's a way that both teams like to play, and you know, everything's on the line here tonight.
What about the desperation factor? Feel that the Bruins have brought that a little more, a little better in this game?
Yeah, definitely. We talked about not waiting till we got down 2-0 to start playing, and you know, we had a good first shift and a pretty good first half of that period. Unfortunately, it took two penalties and it ended up costing us one goal, but we got to regroup and refocus and have a good second here.
Good luck here in the second. Thank you, Milan.
Thank you.
Dale?
Inbound back now to John Moore. Moore led it across, faking the drive, letting it go. Brassard scores! Ribeiro there, Carlson who shot, getting a piece of it, Lundqvist. It'll take seven.
Yeah, just enjoy this now and reset and kind of refocus and, you know, we gotta get a win in their building, and that's just, we just gotta focus on that.
We need to take the momentum and just, you know, keep building off what we did here tonight, and just keep playing to our game plan that we set out to do at the start of the series.
In a big game like this, you don't want to fall behind early, and so that's what I focus on. And as the game move on, you know, I can see the way he's playing in the other net. You know, we had a lot of great chances, especially in the second period, but he kept it 1-0. So then I know I have to be sharp. So I put a little extra pressure on myself.
The other Game 7 going on tonight at the Verizon Center in our nation's capital. The Washington Capitals hosting the New York Rangers. Home team has won every single game of this series so far. Does that automatically mean the Caps tonight?
No, I don't think so, but it's also a situation where we've been talking about great goaltending for both Holtby and Lundqvist, but this is a situation where the stars are going to have to pick it up for both teams. They haven't been playing very well. The role players, the Rangers, Brassard, Hagelin, Boyle, for Washington, Perreault, Ward, Chimier, they've been the top players. They need their stars to pick it up. Go to the next round.
And we talked about it early before the game. Nash, one assist. Yeah. Ovechkin has a couple of points. Richards really hasn't done much. So you'd expect sooner or later one of those guys will come through under pressure. No better time to do it than a game seven.
Well, only one of the goaltenders in that series is a finalist for the Vezina Trophy. That's got to make you feel pretty good if you're a Rangers fan or coach, although I'm never sure John Tortorella ever feels good.
No, I think you'd ask Bruins fans that Holtby did a pretty good job last year against them in the first round, too. So it's going to be a tough, hard fight. Game seven, two teams that play pretty solid team defense, and right now it's going to be, I think, a power play goal or a kind of a odd bounce, because these guys, as you said earlier, Dale, have held home service.
And Lundqvist and Holtby, they both have a resting heart rate of about 40. Neither one of them gets very excited about anything. I remember watching Holtby last year against the Bruins. Every between periods, there'd be all kinds of helter-skelter. He'd be like yawning, taking a drink of water, and that's the way Lundqvist is too. So that's a nice personality trait. That's a little way Tuukka Rask cooks out here tonight as well.
Well, the Bruins have themselves a bit of an uphill climb in this one, not from the scoreboard perspective. They're tied 1-1 at the end of one, but from a personnel perspective. They started this game without Redden, without Ferentz. Seidenberg went down. Turnovers, you guys told me before the game, one of the keys for the Bruins.
Yeah, it was before the game. Now it's even more important without those left-handed defensemen. You have to make sure you get the puck deep. You can't have turnovers at the top here, allowing Toronto in this situation. Marchand doesn't get it deep. All of a sudden, Toronto's allowed to transition play. You have to control the puck down deep. You can't allow Toronto right there. You go through the seam. Now all of a sudden, Toronto comes back. And Gordy, we talked about the defense. If Seidenberg is going to be out, the forwards have got to do a better job of getting the puck deep and protecting the defenseman.
You got Bartkowski, you have McQuaid, and you have Hamilton. They're going to play way more minutes than they expected, the coaching staff expected, in a game seven. They just got to step up and make the plays.
Claude Julien was playing possum with the media before the game when he said, you know, about line combinations, you really have to practice patience. Well, he did what many of the fans were calling for here, and he shuffled things around. Jágr with Bergeron and Marchand. Sagan down with Kelly and Peverly.
Yeah, it certainly worked well. I mean, Jágr, Bergeron, Marchand. Jágr had a couple of great chances. The first couple of shifts, they easily could have scored. It looked like just a new energy, new life to that line. And I think that was really something crucial that Claude Julien had to solve for, because the Marchand, Bergeron, Sagan line was just seemingly getting worse and worse. So he had to shake it up. And I think Jágr was a good move on that line.
Yeah, and I think regardless of the line combinations right now, the forwards have got to be talking in that dressing room about helping out the defense. Without Seidenberg, we've been talking about, you got those three young right defense over there, and all of a sudden somebody's gonna have to play their offside now and then. So this is a situation where the forwards have got to protect the puck, make sure you get it deep, take the body, stay out of the penalty box so that Chara can kind of not have to worry so much about killing penalties in a situation. And the forwards have got to protect their defense this period.
Well, let's talk about Zdeno Chara for a moment. He had a penalty, so he missed 2 minutes there. He's played 10 and a half minutes in the first period already. You know that your big players have to come up big, but boy, that's an awful long, an awful high pace to have to keep up.
Yeah, I think he's going to have to do it. He's going to have to play 30 minutes here tonight. I just don't see any other way around it. He's the best conditioned guy in the team, and he's just going to have to play it under pressure, and that's what he works so hard for, and his conditioning is at the very top of the league.
Yeah, he played 10-plus, Chara. Well, Seidenberg played 37 seconds, so that's not a good combo.
No, not exactly the mix that Claude Julien had in mind going into this one. The Bruins and the Maple Leafs are tied 1-1 at the end of the first period of play. Maple Leafs have had the only two power play opportunities, and they have a power play goal. Second period action coming up next. We'll take you back to Jack Edwards and Andy Brickley after the break.
A quest for history.
Boston Bruins finish the season on top.
A quest for tradition.
And here we go again.
A quest for honor.
You can tear down the building, but not the memories.
A quest for glory. A quest for greatness.
New England has Stanley Cup fever.
The 2013 Quest for the Cup is on Nesson.
Boston Bruins Hockey on Nesson is brought to you by Southwest Airlines, by Amica, by New England Ford, by Mohegan Sun, and by TD Bank, America's most convenient bank. 1-1 after one as the Bruins and Maple Leafs play Game 7 to decide their Eastern Conference quarterfinal series. Alongside Andy Brickley with Nalco Funayama and our Nesson production team, I'm Jack Edwards. Glad you're here with us for this one. The Game 7 facts brought to you by Land Rover. The Maple Leafs playing their 22nd Game 7. Their 14th on the road. They are 12-9 overall, but 8 of those 9 losses have come on the road. The Bruins playing their 24th Game 7. They're 12-11. Dennis Seidenberg played only 37 seconds in the first period and went limping down the tunnel. What do you think, Rick?
Well, he had, you know, two opportunities to make body contact. You know, he started the opening faceoff right in the neutral zone. He had one piece of contact, and then he pinched into the offensive end. Kind of went a little awkward after the spin move by Fratton. And that was the only shift of the first period for Seidenberg. But good news. Back on the Bruin bench to start period two.
I mean,
you're already without Ferentz.
Yep.
No Redden tonight.
Yep.
I mean, both those guys have over 100 games experience.
1,000, yep.
No, in playoffs.
Yep.
Playoffs.
Yep.
Well, that's a big number in playoffs, over 100 games.
Yep, sure.
Ferentz, Redden, and if you lost Seidenberg for a lengthy period of time, which you did in the first period, now you're in real trouble.
Yeah, McQuaid, Hamilton, and Barkowski being the names of three of your five defensemen. First period summary brought to you by your New England Ford dealers. Beverly Settering for the drop, at least, with Sagan and Kelly. Funuf tries to poke it past Chris Kelly. Kelly in front of the Zamboni doors, brings it back. Barkowski, it goes wide, and then back in front on the frictionless ice. Nazem Kadri now trying the self-pass into the corner. Oh, Boychuk goes down, and Kadri's going to go for a penalty. But you got to be concerned for Johnny Boychuk, who went hammering into the boards hard. Rask makes his way to the Boston bench. The Bruins will get a power play here as Kessel has possession. Interference, the call, and I can't read lips from this distance, but I think Nazem Kadri was checking on Johnny Boychuk down there.
Well, it's always one of these dangerous situations because you're at that distance away from the boards and you don't have a chance to defend yourself, and you got a fresh sheet of ice. Nothing to stop you from crashing in the boards. No opportunity to brace for the hit. Kadri goes for interference. See if the Bruins can use their power play to get a little momentum in the offensive end.
Jágr and Chara at the blue lines to start things off. Sagan on the half boards with Bergeron high slot. Lucic in front of the goal. Puck bounces through. Jágr uses the huge reach to tap it through the corner. Put up. Sagan pulls it away. Can't get the shot cleanly off. Jágr on the hash marks all the way around. Sagan catches it on the backhand. Draws Kuhlman, backs it to Chara. Chara has Jágr far side, gives it to him. Gunnarsson comes out to have a look. Down low for Lucic. Lucic off the skate of Kuhlman. Chara knocks it down at the line. Funuf trying to send the puck the length of the ice.
Don't pass through people if you don't have to.
Chara gives to Jágr. 40 seconds gone on the power play. Lucic holds out near the blue line. Bergeron to Chara, the one-timer into Coleman's leg. Bergeron spins it along the line to space. Jágr recovers the puck. Cross ice, it skips past Sagan. The backhand to the end boards. Bergeron all the way around to Jágr. He kicks to the stick. Lucic sends it in deep. Gunnarsson unopposed. Wrists it around. Jágr blocks it again. Lucic the diagonal. Chara's drive. Leaves a dent on the end boards. Gunnarsson can't clear. Chara, Sagan the drive. And that gets tipped up and over. Kuhlman bounces it down the length of the rink.
I think they're going to say it hit the bench area. Bruins are going to get a break here. This will be an offensive zone faceoff. Sagan setting up for the one-timer over on the dot. Chara, his first shot wide on the short side. The clearing attempt by Gunnarsson goes right back to Chara. Chara sells the shot. There's room, and you can see the reaction by Sagan. He rips it up high, just misses up over the crossbar.
39 seconds to go on the power play. Franzen hard around and out. Hamilton has Beverly straight ahead. Marchand on the left. Hamilton overskates the puck. Now it gives it to Beverly. He goes right past Van Riemsdyk to the corner. Wraps it around for Marchand. Marchand absorbs the hit from Komarov, but Komarov takes the loose puck and backhands it down. The Bruins don't get off a shot during their man advantage. Matt Barkowski takes the saucer pass from David Krejci. Wrists it around through both corners. Matt Fratton waiting. Taps it back for Franzen. Pae, Campbell, and Thornton. The forwards out there with Barkowski and Boychuk. Colborne lugs it up to the red line. Campbell intercepts. Transition for the Bruins. Pae driving the net. Campbell across the middle. Juicy rebound. And Colborne takes it right through his own crease and turns it into transition to Fratton. Fratton tries to curl and drag the shot. Saved by Rask. Fratton needed no space at all with which to get off that shot, and Rask makes another save. Barkowski back in the Boston goal. Gets himself a little space, stick handling away from Lupo. Barkowski indirect for Campbell.
Campbell chips to the right wing corner. Gardner takes it on a post. Dita Lyles indirect up the boards for Fratton. Fratton finds Gardner rushing the middle of the ice. Jake Gardner can't get the shot through Bergeron and McQuaid. McQuaid unloads on Kadri and decks him. Here's Marchand. O'Byrne with a big hit. Jágr pulls it back away from Kessel. Marchand kicks to the stick down to the hash marks. Marchand wheels on O'Byrne. Jágr in front. Bergeron the tip try. Van Riemsdyk golfs it to the line but not out. Marchand can't drag it past Kadri. Kadri nudges it ahead to Van Riemsdyk. He charges toward Chara. Van Riemsdyk turns it on, goes to the middle, but Chara got enough of him so he couldn't make the move and complete it. Marchand goes right back to the other end of the ice. Marchand drops for Jágr. Jágr takes Bergeron off the heel of the stick. Reimer slides past the post, but the puck comes into his pads. End to end in Game 7.
Well, the Bruins are trying to get as many pucks to the net as possible. A purposeful shot from a bad angle by Campbell. And again, that rebound is there. Colburn has to skate it through traffic to get out of the danger area. Nice right pad stop by Rask. A little curl and drag of the slot. Van Riemsdyk tries that under the stick move against Chara. Chara's reach and strength just too much. And this is a nice play here. Attack, bring people to you. Marchand's able to do that. The triangle forms. Unfortunately, the one-timer by Bergeron kind of healed a little bit after the feed from Jágr.
Boychuk throws the puck in deep. Sagan gives Finoffo a bump to get him offline, but McClendon's the next layer, and he's there. Orr strong in the stick. Chops down to Barkowski. Sagan makes the steal at the Toronto line. Here's Boychuk over the line. Boychuk takes the hit from Komarov to get the puck deep. Kelly goes in and bangs the hip hard into Gunnarsson. Kelly screwed along and reverses against Finoff. Komarov swipes it past Sagan. Beverly sends the puck back to the goal. Finoff on it again. The Bruins trying to pin Toronto in the Leafs' own end of the ice. McClement back to Finoff. Through Orr. Barkowski waits and then drives it hard around into the zone. McClement gives it away to Horton, but then gets it back. Orr up at the line. Chara hip to hip with him to knock him off the puck. Komarov out of his own zone, right over the spoke beam, and he skips one in on Tuukka Rask. Let's go Bruins, the chant from the TD Garden crowd. Zdeno Chara, oh! Kadri, or rather, Coleman came over and Chara just ran him over in front of the penalty box. MacArthur throws the puck in deep. Grabowski after Hamilton takes his legs out from under him. MacArthur snaps it to Franz and his drive scores! Cody Franz into a wicked screen! He has his second of the game and it's 2-1 Toronto!
Now, pretty nice play. Again, the quickness of the forwards for the Toronto Maple Leafs, able to get to this puck first. Grabowski, he gets taken out, but MacArthur's there for support. That back diagonal and all kinds of bodies in front of Rask, most notably Zdeno Chara. And if you don't get the shot block, things like this will happen. Real good shot by Franz, elevated. Rask trying to go down into that butterfly, make a positional stop when you can't track the puck. And it beats him high to the blocker side. And here's the difference, Jeff. When Toronto gets a power play, score or not, they generate a bunch of shots, they create chances for themselves, and it helps them with the momentum of the hockey game. Yep. Boston gets their power play in the second period of a 1-1 game.
Toronto
it doesn't happen. They're off.
Bruins got away with it in 2011. It stung last year. Here's Campbell in tight, and Reimer makes the save. 13:37 to go in the second period. The Leafs have come from behind to lead Game 7 at TD Garden.
Well, Cody Franzen with the go-ahead goal, giving the Leafs a 2-1 lead. The Bruins are in position. They got that box in one formation that they like to protect, the middle of the ice in their own zone. Lucic has to sag into that slot area as the weak side winger. Now the puck comes back to Franzen. Now Lucic is trying to get in the shooting lane. Chara is trying to get in the shooting lane. Rask is trying to track the puck. And if you don't get shot blocks, whether it's by Lucic or Chara, and that puck gets by, Rask has a very difficult time of seeing that puck, if he sees it at all. But it's a great shot by Franzen. Blocker side high.
First time Cody Franzen has had a two-goal game. And not just in the playoffs. Bruins have just 3 shots on goal to 12 for Toronto since Boston scored in the first 6 minutes of the game. Grabowski takes the loose puck as Gunnarsson locked up Lucic. Matt Fratton pulls up in front of the Boston bench. Grabowski pivots into the Boston zone, throws the puck to the corner. Boychuk absorbs the hit from Lupul. Grabowski the next layer. Lupul tries to come out of the pile with the puck, but there's Krejci. Grabowski contests every inch. Lucic, shoulder to shoulder, Coleman knocks Lucic off the puck. Gardner to Grabowski over the line to MacArthur, looking front for Coleman. Boychuk tries to chop it away. MacArthur wins the puck battle along the end board.
Yeah, real good quick ups by the Leafs. Created a quick 3-on-2.
Barkowski tries to poke it out of the zone. Franzen keeps it in. MacArthur to Gardner. Glove save by Rask. A potential game-changing save by Tuukka Rask as Jake Gardner had the corner picked.
Yeah, you'd hate to use a timeout in this situation in the hockey game. One-goal game, game 7. Maybe you want to keep that in your pocket. But this is a bad feeling right now for the Bruins. They give up the go-ahead goal, and now they're in trouble. They just gave up a 3-on-2. Now they're giving up a quality scoring chance through a defenseman jumping into open space in the high slot.
Rick, this is something we talked about when we saw the original series schedule, that it could finish with 3 games in 4 nights. Franzen back for the icing touch-up. When the Bruins had to play 3 games in 4 nights during the condensed regular season, they were 1-9-1. And on a night on which it looks as if they're going to have to go the rest of the way without Dennis Seidenberg, that is a difficult, difficult task.
Yeah, we pointed out Seidenberg back on the Bruin bench to start the period, but obviously hasn't had a shift yet.
Bergeron wins the faceoff away from Kadri.
You know, it's hard to ignore those kinds of numbers, even though they were regular season numbers, because this is a game 7, whatever it takes to win, win or go home. But you got to dig deep and you got to find your game.
There's no comfort zone anymore. Here's Marchand turning off the half-court's charge, throws it in front. Bergeron on the tip, and Reimer makes the positional save and then does a little 900 spinorama in his goal. Chara battles flat and throws it to Bergeron. Bergeron wheels behind the goal to Jágr. He bangs it off the apron of the net. Bergeron throws it to Jágr. Jágr finds it in the corner, but Fratton intercepts the pass intended for Marchand. O'Byrne having to fight for every inch against Bergeron. Rask out of his goal. Fratton chopping down on Rask's stick. Chara ahead for Marchand. Tries to go wing to wing. Sagan picks it up. He's got Bergeron as a trailer. Sagan goes back of the goal. Banks it for Chara. A good read from Kessel as he redirects it out to the neutral zone. Johnny Boychuk to Kelly. Back to Boychuk in the Boston zone. Lots of 50-foot passes here. Peverly up to the line. Franzen intercepts. Trickles it ahead. Char to Peverly. A 5-foot pass to Sagan, and he gets it in deep. Let's go Bruins, the chant from the Boston crowd. Kessel again gets a piece of the puck. This goes the length of the rink. Boychuk tries to nurse an icing call out of it, and he gets it.
Well, we talked about the need for the Bruins to find their finishing touch when they get their offensive opportunities. Just one goal apiece in the last 2 losses in games 5 and 6. Campbell gets a real good look after a good rush by Bartkowski. Good skating defenseman. He's bringing it to tonight. He has the goal for Boston. Campbell couldn't find open space on the glove side, short side high, and then the redirect of the shot by Char by Bergeron.
Krejci wins the faceoff. It bloops to Lucic. Barkowski keeps it on the line. Snaps it low for Krejci. With Horton in front. Krejci hard off the apron. Takes a big hit from Colborn. Kessel catches the puck and then throws it to space. Lupul trying to outrace McQuaid. McQuaid gets there. Taps to Horton.
Horton reverses back of the goal. McQuaid has Grabowski attacking. He wins the puck. Kuhlman tries to wrap around and Rask
gets to the near post to block Nikolai Kuhlman. Forechecking pressure from Toronto and another good chance for the Leafs.
It's the great speed that they have up front. Grabowski's able to get in, create pressure, cause the turnover. Kuhlman, the second man, he tries to use the net for a quick wraparound when the short side evaporates. But it's the speed of the forwards, the chip out by Kessel, and now McQuaid's in a foot race with a speedier forward barreling down on him.
Kelly and Grabowski. Marchand bangs the puck off the boards. Dion Phaneuf takes it. Carl Gunnarsson up the boards. Coleman stumbles, gets into the Boston zone. Bergeron tries to clean him out with a check. Bergeron banks it underneath Kelly's forehand. Phaneuf takes Gunnarsson's pass, whips it all the way down the ice. Hamilton after it quickly for the icing touch.
Shields Healthcare Group is proud to announce a new partnership with Winchester Hospital. MRI services are available to hospital's new outpatient center in Unicorn Park in Woburn. Go where the pros go and choose Shields MRI.
Sean Yager, Marchand, Barkowski, and Boychuk, the five skaters for Claude Julien. Grabowski gets tossed out of the faceoff circle, and Kuhlman glides in to take it. Yager gets dumped. Yager from his fanny tries to get the puck to the corner. Phaneuf scoops it up to the line and out. Barkowski under pressure from Grabowski. Grabowski tackles Barkowski. And on they go. This will be icing.
Well, once again, the speed of the Toronto forwards, and as Grabowski right in the middle of it again, trying to get up, create turnovers in the offensive zone by using his speed, his elusiveness. Just when you think you have a body on him and you have him angled off, he's able to slide around you because of that quickness. Arguably, a penalty call could have been delivered in that case, in that battle with Barkowski.
Yager's hard drive is high and wide on the glove side. Marchand looking for Bergeron, but Franzen picks it off, and he ices it. Chara beats Van Riemsdyk back for the touch. Cody Franzen. Two goals tonight, but Grabowski's had some chances as well.
Well, it's just great speed, a little chop on the stick to push the puck a little deeper in. He's trying to get around Barkowski and certainly got the crowd's attention with that freehand wrap around the shoulder, but not worthy of a penalty call.
Hamilton saved by Reimer. 9:22 to go in the second period. When the Bruins have fallen behind in game sevens, they're 2-9 all time. So you're saying there's a chance. This legendary moment is brought to you by Captain Morgan. Raise your glass, always in moderation. Nathan Horton, April 27th, 2011. Overtime, game seven, Eastern Conference quarterfinals. The series winning goal. The first step on the way to the Stanley Cup. Coverley and McClement on the faceoff. Sagan tosses back to Hamilton. He wrists it off the end boards. Kelly quickly to the puck against Phaneuf. Taps it low. McClement pivots away. The puck comes right on Reimer. Kelly pops it up. Heavily the quick shift against McClement. Snaps it to Sagan, throws it in front. Van Riemsdyk sprays it to the corner to safety. Sagan to Peverly. Let's go Bruins, the champ from the 17,565. Hamilton shot into the pile. It's loose. Kelly, Phaneuf down on one side and getting up very slowly. Chara with a huge reach gets backward before Van Riemsdyk can get there. Phaneuf laboring to get to the Toronto bench, favoring one of his legs. Kuhlman backs into the Hamilton hit, and Hamilton knocks him off balance, and Chara finishes him off. Phaneuf goes down the tunnel. Gardner backs into his own zone. Cody Franzen. All the way to the attacking line. Kessel got a piece of the puck. Hamilton after with Kadri on his back. Kessel flicks it toward the corner. Hamilton tries again. Lopel shuts down his space. Campbell pops it up. Kessel gets a piece of the puck in the air. Thornton cross ice for Peverly. Peverly, it's offside. Dion Phaneuf paying the price in front of the Toronto goal.
Well, what's that saying? You just never have enough defensemen. The Bruins are going through that right now with Redden and Ferentz and Seidenberg all out of their lineup. And now Dion Phaneuf gets a little stinger when he gets in that shooting lane, trying to stay on the ice and make sure that he's not a liability, but he had to get off and get down the runway, get some attention. 7 games in, Jack. No surprise.
Yeah.
Bodies drop.
Campbell wins the faceoff back to Bartkowski, who sprints over the line, taking on Gardner. Off Gardner's stick, it floats into the corner. Campbell with the big hit, flattening Gunnarsson. Campbell around the goal, throws it in front, nobody home. Kamarov pokes ahead for McClement. McClement takes on McQuaid. Pye with back pressure, breaks up the rush, throws McClement into the dasher at the Toronto bench. Kamarov pulls the puck into the zone after he entered, and it's offside.
Electricity is in the air during the Stanley Cup playoffs. Bruins fans, switch to Gulf Electricity and earn free gas. Visit GulfElectricity.com for details.
Julian's Bruins playing from behind. Of course, they came from 2 goals down to win game 4 up in Toronto. Dougie Hamlet with a puck on edge, sprays it past Lucic. He rolls down the slot. Lucic gives Gunnarsson a check and then slams him into the corner boards. Hamilton to Chara. Chara's drive tipped in front. It goes off the high glass. MacArthur having to battle Horton, gets it forward to Grabowski. Grabowski flies up Hamilton's side. Hamilton puts the bump on him and knocks him off his skates. Krejci patient to find the seam. Grabowski slow to get up. Lucic tape to tape to Horton. Horton for Lucic. Had to fight off Phaneuf for his return. Chara. Phaneuf back to the goal. Knocked down after a confrontation with Lucic, and Lucic banging with Phaneuf. They continue to shove at each other, and now Lucic is going to go all by himself. Dan O'Halloran sends Milan Lucic off.
Job lifting his stick on his net drive. Lucic goes for a rough. Phaneuf does exactly what he wanted to do. In the eyes of the official, Lucic the aggressor. One too many high shot.
Dennis Seidenberg second in shorthanded time on ice for the Boston Bruins. Not available for this penalty kill. Chris Kelly working up ice against Cody Franzen. Kelly, the shift, he keeps possession. Kessel pops it right to Rich Peverly, who throws it across the attacking zone for Boston. Kelly rides Kessel down. 20 seconds gone in the Toronto power play. The Leafs have gotten a surge off of one power play and a goal off of another one. Kessel pokes it forward. Boychuk steps up. Kessel flicks the puck back to the neutral zone. Van Riemsdyk turns away from Bergeron. Boychuk waiting at the line, slams him with the double forearm shiver. Chara takes the puck, scales it forward. Marchand was waiting at the attacking line. Down goes Reimer. Marchand might have clipped him on the way through. Bergeron tears his stick loose from Franzen. Franzen tries to cave him in. Pye's shot zips wide and goes into the corner, but Chara catches the puck at the blue line, sends it around. Daniel Pye turns away from Franzen, goes through MacArthur's legs, who was lining him up for a hit. Nazem Kadri over the red line.
Saucers it for Grabowski on the off wing. Chara on the body check. Campbell goes in. Chara has the puck in his skates. Grabowski flips it to Lyles. The drive, glove saved by Rask with 36 seconds to go. In the penalty, and Grabowski unloads on Campbell well after the whistle. And the referee, Brad Watson, I believe, is pointing at both of them.
Not a whole lot of consistency with the extracurricular. Good play by Rask. It's a good look at it. You're not going to beat him from there. There's a little exchange between Campbell and Grabowski. Grabowski with the extra cross check, but it sure looked like they were both going to go with even amount of penalty minutes. Pretty good opportunity for Danny Pae, shorthanded on a great effort by Patrice Bergeron. Reimer goes down on his own, maybe even a little Fanouf, if it wasn't Marchand. Marchand goes for the change, and Bergeron just continues to win the battle. Presence of mind to know that Pae is coming out for Marchand, wide open on that far side, but Pae, shorthanded bid, wide on the blocker side.
Beverly and Van Riemsdyk with the penalty underway. There is no further reduction in manpower. Jake Gardner working it out of his own end. There's a roughing call.
Here's Kessel's shot, comes off a leg. Jake Gardner pulls it back along the line to Lyles. Lyles draws Keller. Looper at the half boards, looks for a seam. It's back to 5-on-5. Kessel to Looper. Saved by Rask. Looper goes right over the top, and Rask gets the waffle on him twice. Took a Rask more than a little upset that he had his mask removed forcibly. And Chara coming over to have a word with referee Brad Watson. 2-1 Maple Leafs, late second period, Game 7 Eastern Conference quarterfinals at TD Garden.
Tail end of the power play. Toronto Maple Leafs create that 2-on-1 on the overload side. Lupul tries that short side jam and try to get your own rebound. The minute you feel pressure, Jack, from behind, like Boychuk does right there on Lupul, we saw it by Van Riemsdyk the other night. You attack the goaltender. And it sure looked like Lupul took the advantage of knowing that Boychuk pushed him from behind. I'm going to go a little hard into Tuukka Rask. You saw Rask's reaction. A little shot with the blocker to Lupul's head. Char a little something. But that easily could have been a penalty as well. You know, you go back to the highlight we showed Chara and Van Riemsdyk, the battle that they let go. The mixed messages now is what's a penalty and what's not. It's very frustrating, but you got to play through it.
Let's go Bruins, the chant at the Garden. Krejci works it right through Komarov. Krejci to Lucic, but the puck skips as he tries the one-timer. McClement was right on Lucic. McClement gets it up to the line. Komarov brings it through into the Boston zone. 3-on-2. Horton trying to shut down Komarov's space. He comes out the far side, still in control of the puck. Gunnarsson flips to the boards. Krejci hops on it with a pass. Too far forward for Lucic. Put up. Cross ice for Gunnarsson. Lucic unloads on Gunnarsson. Thus the Thunder. Barkowski indirect. Off Phaneuf skate in the Toronto zone. Gives it away to Jágr. Jágr's drive off the strings wide of the post. Phaneuf. Marchand caves him in. Pulls the puck out from his body. Gives to Bergeron in a lot of traffic. One-on-two against Fratton and Lupul. Fratton. Self-pass past Chara. Hamilton locks up Fratton and he keeps on going right into Rask. 3.5 to go in the second. Cody Franson to Colborn. Bergeron unloaded on Colborn, who broke his stick in the collision. Lupul, Fratton, Jágr backhands it to the blue line. Not out. Gardner gets away from Jager's stick, looks for Kadri.
The drive by Franzen and a glove save by Rask.
Well, the Bruins acquiring Jaromir Jagr at the trade deadline, looking to bolster their offense, try to find a quality third line. Forecheck by Marchand creates the turnover by Fanouf, hands it right to Jagr. Jagr goes for the half slap, tries to beat Reimer short side, but hits the side of the net, opposite end of the ice. The Bruins can't work the puck out on Jagr's side. It ends up back at the right point. That's not the guy you want shooting the puck tonight. He's already got a pair at Franzen.
Cabrie, Van Riemsdyk, and Kessel up front. O'Byrne and Lyles, the defensive pair. Boychuk and Van Riemsdyk. Boychuk goes down in the corner. Sagan flips the backhand to Peverly. Sagan drives the net. Peverly stops on the hash marks. O'Byrne locks up with him. Sagan finds Kelly. The puck deflects back into the neutral zone. Van Riemsdyk and Kelly. And Van Riemsdyk's just riding that pony, and Kelly retaliated with an elbow. Sagan throws it right on Reimer, and Reimer pins it against the goal to take the faceoff.
Well, all kinds of body contact, some within the time frame of contact, others maybe a little bit late. Kelly and Van Riemsdyk get locked up on the ice. Kelly fighting his way out of that body pin.
Van Riemsdyk will get a little bit of attention to his schnoz. Krejci wins the draw from McClement. McQuaid up the boards. Lucic. Franzen. Off the Franzen hit. Lucic's shot blocked by Kuhlman, and it goes wide. Chara backpedals at the puck. Wrists it to Lucic. It comes off his stick. McClement feeds it forward. Grabowski to Kuhlman. Chara breaks that up. Lucic gets back pressure from Kuhlman, takes the stick out of Kuhlman's hands, but Kuhlman won the puck. Franzen to Jake Gardner. Right against the puck first. MacArthur cycling through the corner. McQuaid has broken his stick. He's the defenseman in front of the goal, and Tuukka Rask wisely shuts it down to get a faceoff with McQuaid on the long change, playing without his stick.
Like the official Boston Bruins Facebook page, your one-stop for contest photos, news, and everything Bruins. Like the Bruins today at facebook.com/NHL Bruins.
Bergeron and Colborn on the faceoff. Marchand tries to come right through. And he goes down over a stick. What is the threshold tonight? It's rule tripping.
Well, Marchand's going to try to step through on this faceoff and play the puck.
Rabbit just stepped on the stick.
Yeah, Lupo's trying to play that puck. To figure. Well, I understand the shakes of the head. It's happening in both directions. But now, more importantly, Bruin power play needs to be better than their first opportunity.
Off the drop, Kuhlman takes the puck and taps it all the way behind Chara. He's going to race into pressure. Jaromir Jagr carries to the line. Gets broken up as he tried to stick handle through McClement. McClement, an excellent penalty killer. It's rare that you see a forward lead the entire team in shorthanded time on ice per game. But he does for Toronto. Lucic through the corner against Fanouf. Gives to Jagr. Chara tapping the stick out at the point. Lucic comes right to goal. Jagr recovers the loose puck, doesn't get much on the pass. Van Riemsdyk smacks it hard off of Chara, and it comes the length of the rink. Minutes to go in the second.
1 minute remaining in the period.
A little more than that remaining on Boston's power play. Brad Marchand into the attacking zone against Franzen. Marchand holds the puck at the edge of his control. Beverly at the blue line, the diagonal for Krejci. Krejci to Hamilton to Beverly. Beverly cross ice pass gets deflected. Krejci picks it up, drags it back to the half boards. Low for Marchand. Marchand to Krejci at the hash marks. Half a minute to go in the period. Cross ice. Marchand tries to jam it past Reimer and can't. Hamilton slap pass to Krejci. Marchand gets knocked down in front. Krejci swivels to Hamilton, who makes a nice play, then goes indirect to Krejci in the final 20 seconds of the period. Orton to Krejci. Krejci to Hamilton, tees it up. The wrist shot, Pullman with the block. 6 seconds to go in the period. Krejci low for Horton, looking for Lucic, but the pass gets deflected. Beverly to Krejci out high, but the period expires. And it'll go to the third. Toronto leading game 7, 2-1.
The second power play unit doing more effective work by moving it quickly, creating some two-on-ones. You watch the Leafs power play with Kessel and Phaneuf creating the two-on-ones out high, allowing Franzen to get open on the wide side. That second unit worked that triangle umbrella high, much more effective than the unit that had Jagr on it.
Dale, Toronto has 8 shots on 3 power plays tonight and 1 goal. And it's a 1-goal game. Boston is about to conclude its second power play. The Bruins have yet to have a power play shot on goal. There's your story, or at least one of them.
Well, you're exactly right, Jack. 2-1 Toronto with the lead after 2 periods of play here with Barry Peterson and Gord Kluzak. It's getting a little chippy. It's getting a little, well, quite honestly, I don't think anybody knows what a penalty is at this point.
No, it is very chippy. It looks like the referees are getting very close to losing this hockey game. But, Gordy, the Bruins' power play has really been putting them back that period. Just when they started to get some momentum, they go on the power play, and all of a sudden it would suck all the energy out of that building.
Yeah, not a lot of creativity, not enough one-touch passes, not getting the puck on net. Yeah. Just throw it to the net and see if you can get a rebound or deflection or something.
Well, we'll come back and break it all down for you as the Toronto Maple Leafs lead the Boston Bruins 2-1 at the end of 2 periods here at the TD Garden in Game 7. Stay tuned after the game for extended Bruins coverage on Ace Ticket Bruins Overtime Live and Nesson Daily, live from our Garden studio with Barry and Gordy. The aforementioned sitting here with me as the Bruins trail the Maple Leafs 2-1 at the end of 2 periods of play, deciding game 7 in this Eastern Conference quarterfinal round series. Barry, you were talking about it earlier. Sometimes a bad power play is worse than no power play at all because it takes all the momentum away from
it. Yeah, it really does. I mean, here we are early in the second period, scored 1-1. Bruins are at home, they're on the power play. They got a full 2 minutes here, and the Bruins missed the net 3 times. They have the puck along the boards. Everything's on the perimeter. Look, there's no one in front of the net to cause some havoc. All of a sudden, you're going to see this puck really easy. Reimer is. The Bruins are just running around. They're not getting any good set plays off anything. They're missing the net there on Tyler Seguin. That's a situation, Gordy, in the game. It's 1-1. You're at home. A good power play can really get the crowd back into it and get some momentum for you.
Yeah, and you can see Tyler Seguin. He is really feeling it. He's gripping that stick so tight. He shoots the puck and it goes way high. Those aren't the kind of shots you're used to seeing from him on that off wing. He's the guy that really has to be the weapon on the power play.
Cody Frentzen has both of the Maple Leaf goals in this one in a 2-1 lead for Toronto. Gordy, the second one was a real seeing eye job.
It was, and the Leafs get the puck down low, work it back to the point, have some screen in front, included Zdeno Chara. I'm not sure if it touches Chara's glove or not on the way by, but Tuukka Rask, there's no way he could see it. It was a bit of a looping shot, kind of goes up and down and right in the top part of the net.
We talk about the game sevens, all of a sudden unlikely heroes. Here's a young kid with 2 goals ahead. That's his first 2 goals, I think, in his NHL career.
Well, good, we mentioned him, that things were perhaps on the verge of getting out of hand in this one. We've seen some scrums. We've seen some altercations where the referees may have to be careful in this one.
Yeah, you can see frustrations are really getting high here. You can see guys are pushing each other after the whistle. Cheap shots down low. Here's a situation where Phaneuf's going after Lucic. He's trying to get in his kitchen. Watch him use his stick here a little bit. He whacks in the back of the leg. Lucic comes over to him. Phaneuf's not going to go. He's got the shield on. He knows that. And all of a sudden, Lucic just loses it. He goes in the penalty box. That's 2 minutes. We go down the other end here. Situate Campbell and Grabowski out front here. This is a situation where, bang, they're coming late after a whistle. Both of them are pushing. The refs are trying to get in there
and
keep control.
Tell me what the roughing part is there against Campbell.
Well, I think they're both in there just kind of pushing away. play, and the ref wanted to make sure nothing happened. There, this, to me, was the worst one. Lupo right in here with Rask. This has got to be 2 minutes. He got pushed a little bit from behind, but he went right on top of him. And then Van Riemsdyk and Kelly in here. You see Kelly get up. He gives him a little shot there. Bruins got to be careful here. You can't spend any more time in the penalty box.
No, I mean, as good as
little
that
shot?
Might, as, good as,
yeah.
As good as that might feel to dish one of those out to a guy you've been battling with, you just can't afford to do that. Those kind of a power play at this stage in the game, because it's a retaliation penalty, no way, can't be done.
Kelly got away with that one. Gordy, one of our themes coming into tonight's game was turnovers. What have you seen in that department tonight?
You know, it's tough. I mean, the Bruins are playing with a depleted defensive core. That means, Barry mentioned it earlier, the forwards really have to be extra careful with a puck. You turn that puck over and you let this young Leafs team take off in the neutral zone or in your zone. It's really a premium to make those high percentage plays, get those pucks in deep. Don't be trying to go through the middle. Don't be trying to make those sort of hope passes. You can't be doing it. You have to protect your defense. The defense is doing the best they can, but it's really difficult for a Bartkowski and a McQuaid and a Hamilton to be playing as many minutes as they are in this situation.
Taking a look at the Ford game summary, Toronto with the 2-1 lead. They've outshot the Bruins 20-13. They've had three power play tries. Bruins are completing their second one right now. Matt Bartkowski scores not only his first goal of the playoffs, but his first NHL goal unassisted in the first. Cody France and then got the next two, the first on the power play, and then the goal there in the second period. That's the difference in this one. 2-1 is our score through two periods of play. Bruins defenseman Johnny Boychuk downstairs with Nauko Funayama.
Johnny, what do you make of this period? Six shots. How do you generate more?
Just got to, you know, try to get in deep and create some turnovers and, you know, just get our shots through and get to the front of the net.
Now, you're playing with two regular defensemen out. We don't see Seidenberg playing. How difficult has it been, and what kind of communication have you had with the two guys that have had to increase their ice time in Bartkowski and Hamilton?
Just got a lot of talk. You know, when you're in your own zone, you have to talk a lot and, you know, have some quick changes when you need it. And, you know, just, you know, make the simple plays.
How do you look to take this to another level, down by one, going into the third?
Getting in deep, getting on the forecheck, hitting guys, and, you know, just creating those chances.
Can you sense the team is willing to dig deep here?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Good luck here in the third. Thank you, Johnny.
Thanks.
Dale.
When we come back in just a couple of minutes, there's another Game 7 going on in the Eastern Conference here tonight. We'll have highlights from the game in Washington between the Rangers and the Capitals. The Rangers at the Capitals in the other Game 7 tonight. First period, Matt Green collects the stretch pass in all alone, but Henrik Lundqvist makes the save. Now the rebound kicks out to Chris Kreider. He's got the hot man rush. They head the other way. Kreider drops it for Aaron Asham. He rips the slap shot pass. Braden Holtby, Asham's second goal of the playoffs, makes it 1-0 Rangers.
Another role player. We keep talking about these Rangers stars having to pick up, but you get that Lundqvist goaltending, and all of a sudden, one or two goals from the role players is enough, Blues.
Beautiful shot. A little bit of a screen short, about halfway up the post on the short side. Perfectly placed.
Well, we know the matchups in the Western Conference. The number 7 Detroit Red Wings, off their upset of Anaheim, will take on the number 1 Chicago Blackhawks. And the number 6 San Jose Sharks, after beating Vancouver, takes on the defending Stanley Cup champion Los Angeles Kings. The question is, can the Red Wings do it a second straight series?
We'll have to see. Chicago obviously well rested after beating many in 5 games, and all of a sudden Detroit having to go 7. But we talked about the pregame. Two teams that kind of went at it different ways, didn't they? Chicago obviously didn't lose, I think, 24 games, won the President's Cup. Detroit has to get a point on the last game of the season just to make the playoffs.
Detroit 7 or 8 years ago, maybe they take on Chicago, but I don't think so, not this time around.
As you see, the Blackhawks kind of had their way with the Red Wings in the regular season series, outscoring the Wings 12-5. The other Western Conference semifinal is a battle for California, San Jose, and Los Angeles. And what we do know, Gordy, is we're going to see great goaltending in this one with Quick and Niemi.
Yeah, Niemi, Quick. Boy, they have proven themselves in the Stanley Cup playoffs. And Jonathan Quick last year was just phenomenal. And he really brought that team back against a two-game deficit against St. Louis Blues this year.
It's the first time that LA's been kind of the favorite, I guess, right? They're They're having home ice advantage. They've won five series in a row as the dog road team. See how they handle that home ice advantage.
Bruins down by a goal as we go into the third period. Dennis Seidenberg lasted only 37 seconds in this game before he got injured, and thus the defensive time on ice is really skewed.
It is. And Zdeno Chara, 22 minutes. Thank goodness he had a penalty. He got a couple minutes off. Boychuk, 17. Hamilton, McQuaid playing a lot of minutes as well. And I think you see the Bruins have not been able to really get a lot of flow going offensively. And I think a lot of it has to do with minutes being played without Ferentz, without Redden, without Seidenberg. Those are guys that were really part of the flow, really part of the what you're talking about, getting the defenseman into the play, jumping up. The Bruins are behind. Hamilton certainly has offensive ability. Bartkowski has good skating ability. They're going to have to really go for it in this third period.
Tuukka Rask, it would seem as though the Maple Leafs' game plan in this series is try to get him off his game and go at him a few times.
Yeah, he's been great here, though. This is a situation where he's going to have to steal this game for the Bruins. He can't allow any more goals against the offense right now. We talked about it struggling. The defense has been depleted. They're going to need Tuukka to continue to play the way he's playing, but he can't let any more goals in. He has been the reason they're even in this game. I mean, they've been outshot 20-13. Was one power play goal by Franz that really kind of turned things around early. But boy, he's given his team a chance to win.
He has, and the Bruins somehow, some way, have to dig deep. But the odds are stacked against him in this third period.
At least 20 minutes left in Game 7 of the Eastern Conference Quarterfinals. The Bruins and Leafs. Bruins down by a goal. We'll go back to Jack and Brick after the break.
Boston Bruins Hockey on Nesson is brought to you by Subaru of New England, by Sullivan Tire, by your local Nissan dealers, by the Massachusetts State Lottery, and by Southwest Airlines. There's 20 minutes left in somebody's season. Toronto leads the Bruins 2-1 going into the third period of Game 7. Alongside Andy Brickley with Nalco Funayama at ice level and our Nesson production team, I'm Jack Edwards. The crowd rising as the Bruins return to the ice. Boston desperate to tie this game up. Nalco Funayama, what's the mood downstairs?
Well, I had a chance to talk to assistant coach Doug Jarvis, who says now we have to put shots on from absolutely everywhere. 5-on-5, power play, doesn't matter. Shots from the point, shots from poor angles, but the puck has to get to the blue paint. Now, they are dealing, of course, today with a depleted defense, but they've got two young players in Dougie Hamilton and Matt Bartkowski who can transport the puck, and this is a chance for them to show that skill. But the season is down to 20 minutes here, and Jarvis says they have to find a way. And Johnny Boychuk told us between periods, yes, there is much more left in the tank, Brick.
Yeah, 20 minutes or more is what the season's down to, Jack. You can't convince me that this game's going to last just 20 minutes. The Bruins, they have to make some adjustments with their game, though. I mean, you know, Toronto, with their speed up front, has given them problems coming out of their own zone at times. But Boston needs to spend time in the offensive end. The way they started this hockey game, think about those great opportunities. Krejci right off the bat, Jarga right off the bat. And if they get another power play, you know, you got to move the puck quick. If you want to put pucks to the net, what an opportunity with a man advantage. Don't turn down an opportunity to put the puck on goal.
Brick, one of the first comments you made this season was the Bruins have another gear. We've never seen it. Well, they got it in their transmission, but now's the time. They got to show it now. The game summary brought to you by your New England Ford dealers. Third period underway. This will pretty much kill off the remaining seconds in the Boston power play. The Bruins 0-for-2 with zero shots on goal with the man advantage tonight. Brad Marchand closes the shot, save, juicy rebound. Lupul chops it out through the neutral zone. Chara glides back, and it'll be icing against the Leafs, who tried desperately. No, there's no icing rule. Here's Komarov in front for MacArthur. I thought I saw the trailing linesman with his hand in the air. I must have been mistaken. Jágr swivels over the red line. Boychuk chips down to the corner. Jágr goes in. Franzen gets body position. Gardner hard off the boards, and that one goes down. And that will be icing.
the rebounds by Reimer, Jack, are not really going to the side of the net, are they? They're going back to the front of the net in the slot area. When Marshall lets the shot go, that net drive by one of the other forwards has got to be right down the middle of the offensive zone.
Here's what a juicy rebound is. One that's between the circles and closer to the hash marks than the goal. Prime goal-scoring territory. There's been a lot of juice in this series, but the Bruins haven't had too much to drink of it. Bartkowski snaps the one-timer, and Reimer scoops the puck off the ice. 15 goals in 7 games against Washington in the first round last year. 18 goals in 6 2/3 games against the Maple Leafs in the first round this year. The Bruins have not been offensively explosive. They have got to find a way here in the final 19 minutes.
Yeah, 3 goals in the last, 8 periods plus.
Dion Phaneuf snaps the puck around the boards. Clark MacArthur knocks it down. Makes the patient turn with it, and Lucic mashes him. Bartkowski gives back. Krejci returns to Boychuk. Zdeno Chara had played. Oh, here's a giveaway. Grabowski, what a save by Rask. Still loose in front, and Rask has to paddle it to the corner with Kessel on his doorstep. A potential game-clinching sequence there from Toronto. Bartkowski flying through the neutral zone. The Boston defenseman gives to Krejci. Krejci in front. The jam play from Sagan. Kadri ahead to Van Riemsdyk. Wing to wing to Kessel. He can't knock down the pass. Gives way to Lucic. Van Riemsdyk swoops through and takes it. He comes off the half boards. The shot saved by Rask. Rebound hit the post. Kessel scores. Phil's biggest thrill. He makes it 3-1 Toronto. And the Leafs are in command in Game 7.
Well, once again, the speed of the Leafs. Getting to loose pucks in the offensive zone. Because of the rush up ice by Bartkowski. Now Lucic is first back. Kessel's going to bail out. Allow Lucic to get there first. But then here comes Van Riemsdyk. Who's in coverage? Sagan has an opportunity to go at him and close. He just kind of backs off and plays center field. A high shot against Rask. That creates the rebound. And Bruins just get caught watching the paint dry. And there's Kessel just finding open space. Able to get to the rebound with a wide open net. Just breakdowns all around in coverage.
A stunned TD Garden crowd. Now the Bruins not only need one, they need one in a hurry. Chara for Kelly. Franzen flicks the puck out to the neutral zone. Matt Fratton ahead to Joffrey Lupoli. Wrists it around past Chara. Joe Colborne reverses. Chara picks up the puck. He's got Kelly up ahead. Chara indirect Kelly. Makes the pivot. Gives the penalty. Flying into the attacking zone. Horton cuts to the middle. Penalty shot. Save the rebound. Gardner knocks it down. Only white sweaters in front of the goal as there was another rebound, but no Bruins there to knock it in. Now Franzen caves in Kelly on the end boards. Fratton turns the right side and hoists it over everybody. It rolls down into the corner. Hamilton around to Bartkowski. Daniel Pais speeds into the Toronto end. Pais drive rattles high off glass, comes out to center. McQuaid drills it past Lyles. Campbell tags up to get onside, wrists it around the boards. Pais lets it go back to McQuaid, throws it through the goal mouth, nobody home. Bartkowski, slap pass down low, it comes off Campbell's stick to the near boards. Campbell quickly on it, cycles it low for Pai. Lyles wedges down on him. Thornton pulling him out of the corner. Thornton turns it toward goal. Campbell tries to poke it in front and does. Thornton's shot knocked down. It never got through. And the Leafs ice. The Campbell line with some excellent energy as the Bruins take it toward Reimer's goal, but can't get it across the line.
Well, Thornton gets the best opportunity. The puck finds him cruising right through the slot. I think it hit MacArthur just standing in front of the net. Leafs just kind of trying to pack it in around the front of the net. Oh, I think it hit Reimer, actually. Initially, I thought this puck hit MacArthur, or maybe the stick right in the shooting lane. No matter what, I don't think it ever really was a threat, as it turns out. But what an opportunity it was. But a real strong shift by the energy line.
Grabowski pumps Marchand. Marchand off the kick plate. Wiles, Bergeron intercepts. Jágr, everyone backs off. No one wants to confront him. Now two men go in and they win the puck away. Grabowski and Lyles going after it. Grabowski just throws it forward and up. Icing against Boston. Glance at the clock, 15 and a half to go. Bergeron wins the faceoff away from Kadri. Hamilton to Chara, looks long through the middle, but a good read from Gardner to pick off the pass intended for Marchand. Marchand working over Gardner. Got the stick up high a couple times. This is icing.
Yeah. Well, Bruins need something right now, Jack. Thornton had the opportunity. Real good shift by that line. Reimer just prone to the ice. Thornton's trying to get this puck elevated, which he does, right in the side of the head. Couldn't tell at first look whether it was MacArthur that got a piece or if it was a stick in the shooting lane, but it was actually the mask of Reimer that somehow gets in the way.
Kadri wins the faceoff against Krejci. Franzen, Kessel bounces it into the neutral zone. Lucic turns it right back, drops it on the line for McQuaid. The backhand all the way around, Sagan. Plastered on Franzen's hit. McQuaid through the corner. Sagan lets it run to Chara on the hash marks. The captain takes it back of the goal. Chara turns to the forehand, looks for Krejci. Kessel snaps the pass away. Lucic would rotate it for Chara. Can't get the shot through Kessel, who's all over the defensive zone. Lucic fires it off Franzen's skates. Van Riemsdyk unopposed. Tries to set it up the wall. Gardner to Kadri. It's 2-on-1 against McQuaid. Kessel closes. Kick save, last rebound, scores! Nazem Kadri! And the Leafs are running the Bruins out of their own building. It's 4-1 in the third period of Game 7.
Now Chara on the pinch down, trying to create some offense for Boston. They were trailing by two on this shift. But the Leafs do a good job, keep things to the perimeter. Kadri with a nice pass to Kessel. What a great shot by Kessel. You see this drill in practice just about every day. Two on ones. If you don't have a shot that you like, short side, high, up over the glove, where you like to go, perhaps. And you know Kadri's coming in looking for a rebound opportunity. You fire that puck about 6 inches off the ice, low to the stick side. Rask makes the stop, but it delivers the rebound. A shot with a purpose by Kessel on the two-on-one, and Kadri with the follow-up finish.
The Toronto Maple Leafs, unless they suffer a colossal collapse, are going to eliminate the Boston Bruins. 14 minutes is a lot of hockey, but Boston is going to have to score as many goals in that stretch of time as it has in the last three games. Matt Barkowski, Coleman swats the puck to the boards. A subdued TD Garden. Matt Fratton with the stutter step on Barkowski. Brings it back to Franzen along the line to Gardner. Gardner fakes the shot, tosses it through the corner. Fratton picks it up, keeps the legs moving. Grabowski on the cycle as the Bruins begin to get booed. Lupul rotating it. Grabowski on the cycle. Just zone time for the Leafs here. Barkowski trying to grab Fratton out of frustration. And finally, the Bruins are able to get it out of their own zone. Horton softly up the boards, but he doesn't get it past Gardner, so the Bruins can't make a complete change. Here's Leupel swerving to the top of the slot. The wrist shot goes well wide. Leupel on the far side wraps it around through the corner. The puck at the post. Colborne tries to get it middle. Paille turns back in the Boston goal. Daniel Paille accelerates out of the Bruins' end. Lyles pops it out of the air. Colton Orr gives it back. O'Byrne turns the stick and flicks it forward. Orr chips past Chara and chases it in deep. Komarov and Chara go shoulder to shoulder. McClement in the corner. Campbell gives him a bump. Thornton rips it around. Paille bangs Lyles, but with plenty of energy, Colton Orr gets to the blue line. Hamilton says his stick was slashed. He drops both pieces right in the face of referee Dan O'Halloran, who remains unmoved. Daniel Paille lugs the puck into the Toronto end. Drops for Jágr. Jágr against Phillip. In front for Paille. Bergeron's rebound. The backhand sails wide and high. Jágr to McQuaid. The one-timer goes wide. Bergeron getting knocked down in front. McClement off the boards. It bounces down in the Boston end. Adam McQuaid sends the puck to Bergeron. Drops it off the boards for Jágr. Jágr protects all the way to the dot. Panuff chops it right to Barkowski. The wrist shot goes wide. McQuaid through the corner. Marchand using Jager's position as a pick. Sends it to Jágr, bottom of the circle. Jágr on the perimeter. A little swivel. McQuaid's drive with Bergeron going for the tip. Barkowski taps it low. Marchand spins away from Panuff. Jágr battles for the puck. Gunnarsson bumps Jágr. Jágr, the backhand of Barkowski, fakes the shot. The backhand pass to McQuaid, down low to Marchand. Marchand goes around, Panuff flips it across the goal line. Jágr shoots right into Reimer's pads. 11:02 to go in the game. 11:02 to go in the season, unless the Bruins stage a miraculous comeback. The Amica Coverage Cam, presented by Amica Insurance. Great service, great coverage, and a great price for auto, home, or life insurance.
Well, the Bruins are pressing, trailing by a pair of goals, and they got four players from the tops of the circles down in the offensive zone, and now you're in trouble, because if you don't get the puck along the wall, this is what you're going to get. You're going to get a two-on-one against McQuaid. Kadri takes that nice little feed from along the wall, move that puck wide to Kessel, shot with a purpose. Create the rebound, create the second chance opportunity. It's a nice bounce, but it's well designed. Bruins pressing, they need more offense. Toronto takes advantage of it.
Grabowski challenges Chara. Chara wins the puck battle. Krejci, the serpentine route through the neutral zone. Lucic charges down the left wing, throws it right in front. Horton scores! 10:42 to go! Power drive by Milan Lucic to set up Nathan Horton.
Well, this line certainly has carried the majority of the offense for the Bruins in this series. A nice play by David Krejci through center ice. Hang on to it just long enough to draw some people to you. Hit Lucic in stride with speed to the outside. And even though the Leafs have players back, Horton's able to find a seam away from Kuhlman. And it's a nice pass from Lucic. And Nathan Horton, he can be a great equalizer because he can score goals.
The buzz is back in the building. But the Bruins need another one, just to give themselves a chance to get even. Here comes Barkowski flying. Thornton cross corner. High off glass and drops from Paille. Couldn't swipe it past, put up in one try. Colborne absorbs the check from Thornton. Paille deep for Campbell. Campbell off the boards. Thornton throws it deep. Paille, the good effort to get it away from Gunnarsson. Campbell back to Boychuk. Boychuk's drive tipped by Thornton, and it goes off the end glass. Back front, Thornton hits him. Boychuk back after the puck. Turns away from Leupel. The Bruins changing. Chara up the boards. Kadri gets a piece of the puck. Lucic swivels to Krejci, back to Chara. Chara looked north and south. Lucic wants to come east and west. And the Leafs get a piece of it on the way back to the bench. 9.5 to go, and the crowd loud again. Krejci races up the lane, drops to Lucic. The drive save. Juicy rebound. Chara in after it. Kadri begging for the pass, and Lucic gets in the lane as Kessel was going to try to get it up. Hamilton up to the line. Gardner picks it off. Kessel working the off wing against Dougie Hamilton. The stop and start. Hamilton chops down on the stick. Gardner takes it away as Horton was trying to get out of the zone. Bartkowski with the reach. Gardner gets the body in good position. Now Bartkowski uses his body to wedge him off the puck. Two rookie defensemen out there for the Bruins in the last 9 minutes of a playoff game. And a game seven at that. Dougie Hamilton. Little miscommunication. He thought there was something there that wasn't. Jágr and Phillip lock up. They both go down. Bouncing puck. McQuaid keeps it on the line. Tosses the backhand off the end glass. Marchand after it against Gunnarsson. Bergeron wins it to Marchand. Marchand and Jágr in the corner. Marchand runs smack into Jágr, and they both go for a spill. Toronto clears.
Jágr's got to bail here. He's got to get out. He's just right in Marchand's way. You got to get towards the front of the net. Let Marchand have the options of moving the puck.
McQuaid, the Bruins desperate and taking chances all over the ice. Here's Jágr in the corner against Joe Colborne. Jágr goes down. Chara holds the puck at the blue line, backhands it into the slot. Lyles on the loose puck. Bergeron lifts the stick up front. And Chara's wrist shot. And Reimer hangs onto it. Lyles battling with Marchand at the post after the whistle. 7:46 to go. The Bruins down three, get one back from Nathan Horton. Phil Kessel with a third period goal and a third period assist to give Toronto a momentary 4-1 lead. Nathan Horton has cut it to 4-2. So puck management always at a premium, but how do you do that at the same time that you're desperate to generate offense?
Well, I play two lines the rest of the way, basically. I got Krejci on the ice as much as I can with his group, and I got Bergeron on the ice. Maybe that'll take up 6 of the 7.5 minutes. You find a third unit, really, that you can mix and match to get on the ice, but those are the guys I need out there right now if they're going to score a couple of more goals.
Well, you know who Claude Julien thinks are the money players, because they're the ones who are going to get the rest of the ice time. Desperate times for Boston. Down two in its own building. Back half of the third period in game seven against the Toronto team that has for a couple of years shown a tremendous amount of fight and energy. Hamilton shatters Grabowski's stick on the body check. Let's go Bruins, the chant from the TD Garden crowd, which has not given up on this team. Lucic slings the puck all the way around through both corners. Hamilton closes the shot. Juicy rebound past the hash mark. No Bruins on it. Hamilton tries to get it wing to wing. Second effort. He telegraphed it. MacArthur takes it. Fratton trying to sneak through. He's ahead of the pack. No angle on the shot. And he misses the goal off the corner glass. Lupel just wants to get it deep. Fratton sets up the cycle. Peverly taps the puck. Fratton chips it back. It goes through the deadwood to Lupel. Lucic unloads on Lupel. The puck trickles into the middle. Peverly to Krejci. Krejci back to Peverly, racing up the wing against Gardner. Peverly, the hesitation keeps going. He's got Sagan middle. Brings it back to Bartkowski at the middle of the blue line. Bartkowski on a tour of the attacking zone. The chip pass past Chara to Sagan on the end boards. Peverly goes around after it. Chris Kelly keeping the puck alive against Matt Fratton. Back to the blue line, but not out. Bartkowski hesitates, closes. The wrist shot tipped by Sagan. Right in front, behind Reimer, past the post. And Chara could not find it with his stick in the crease. Rich Peverly right over the spoke B. Veers against Kadri. Peverly swerves back, gives to McQuaid. He bunts the puck to the corner. O'Byrne beats Sagan to it. McQuaid to Sagan. tries to A-frame, gets the puck through to Kelly, back to Sagan. Sagan working in the left wing corner, spins away from Kadri, steps on the puck. Kadri takes it right through his own crease. Lupo hard off the boards. McQuaid in a race against Kessel. Rask has to come out to play it into Marchand's body at the Boston line. Less than 6 minutes to go. Kadri with a hard hit on Marchand, and the Leafs swipe it in deep once again. 5.5 to go. Adam McQuaid wrists it all the way around past Reimer. Marchand in the corner. Marchand gets checked by Grabowski. Finds Boychuk. Boychuk's shot. Jágr was down in the corner, and Fanouf was just riding the horse there, keeping him from getting up. Hamilton cross ice. Jágr tags up. Fanouf to Gunnarsson. He flicks it off glass through center. This will be icing with 4:58 to go.
Well, a play that's generated from below the goal line after the shot by Bartkowski. The redirect actually gets knocked down by Sagan. He gets it behind Reimer. Chara charging towards the net from the off point. Tries to get his stick in there and find it. Just too many sticks by the Leafs. Holbert back, Lupo back. Good idea, just couldn't connect.
And here's the other gear. But did they push in the clutch and shift it into overdrive too late? Kurleman breaks forward against Dougie Hamilton, spreads it wide, dumps it in, gets a clean change. Hamilton flies into the neutral zone. Smacks it around through both corners. Lucic drops it for Krejci. Krejci to Lucic in the corner. Into the circle. It rebounds to Reimer, and he covers. 4:34 to go before the Leafs are heroes in Toronto forever. It's been a long time since they've been in the playoffs at all. They're 4.5 away from a series win. It was 2-1 Toronto coming into the third.
And then the Toronto Maple Leaf speed up front caused problems for Boston. Kessel on the doorstep. Kadri doing a job. Van Riems like doing the job. And then a 2-on-1 with the Bruins down by a pair. We're pressing, trying to create some offense. Once they get inside that 10-minute mark, 2-on-1. Kessel with a purposeful shot. Rebound to Kadri. And then the Bruins trying to make one final surge. Again, it's the Krejci line with Milan Lucic straight ahead speed, circling the net, finding Nathan Horton in the slot. That's where we stand, 4-2.
Krejci gets tossed out of the faceoff against Jay McClement. Lucic will take it, wins it to the boards. Horton taps for Boychuk, trickles it down the slot. Lucic wrestling Gunnarsson and McClement. Horton tries to chip it middle. McClement blocks it. Boychuk cross ice. Krejci getting knocked down away from the puck by Gunnarsson, and on they go. Boychuk leaves the puck for Bartkowski. Bartkowski to Krejci. He rushes toward Fanouf, comes cross ice. McArthur just got a piece of the puck. Lucic hits Gunnarsson, and he goes into the boards hard. Fanouf off the boards for Kuhlman. Grabowski against Horton. Krejci's offside. The faceoff in the neutral zone with less than 4 minutes to go in the game. The Bruins absolutely cannot take a penalty now.
Big time hit by Milan Lucic, and that's what Dion Phaneuf is chatting with him about. It was on Gunnarsson. Phaneuf and Gunnarsson have been paired up. Randy Carlyle opting to use them against the Krejci line. Once the Krejci line established their dominance in this series, they've accounted for both goals again tonight for Boston, although they find themselves down by a pair of goals.
Bergeron, Jágr, and Marchand against Colborn, Lupel, and Fratton. Zdeno Chara, Patrice Bergeron kicks it over the line onside. Chara in the middle, runs into the check. Hamilton, here's a break for Fratton, a highly skilled scorer. He deeks, and he misses wide on the backhand. Three and a half to go. Hamilton the diagonal. Jágr goes to the corner to beat Franzen. Franzen tries to staple him in. Jágr tips the puck over, but Gardner chops it around. Hamilton bumps Lupe. Lupe takes a whack at it. Gardner behind the Toronto goal to Franzen. Franzen off the boards. Fratton can't get it out. Franzen has a second chance, and Lupe gets the puck to the neutral zone with less than 3 minutes to go. Rich Beverly, the deke, to get around Lupe, but loses control of the puck, and McClement just slaps it in deep. The clock, Toronto's ally. The Leafs will cut their shifts short, chip the puck deep, and make the Bruins work at 200 feet. Bouncing puck going wide of Reimer. He steers it to the corner. Sagan to Beverly. The puck trickles across the goal mouth. Kelly was locked up with Phaneuf near the goal. Less than two and a half. Barkowski to Kelly off of Beverly. Van Riemsdyk trying to extend. Boychuk gets body position and throws it to the opposite corner. Van Riemsdyk tries to staple in Barkowski and then just one-hands it for Grabowski. Boychuk levels Grabowski. Krejci shields the puck. Lugs it over the spoke. B tosses it ahead of Horton. Rask has gone to the Boston bench. The Bruins pull the goalie with 2 minutes to go. Down two goals. Jake Gardner comes around the goal. Brings it forward to Clark MacArthur. He taps it in deep. Grabowski in pursuit against Chara. Lucic gets it around Kulman. Krejci to Lucic against Phaneuf. The self-pass. Lucic unloads on Gunnarsson. Takes a hit from Phaneuf. Horton saucers the backhand to Chara. Chara's drive saved by Reimer. Bergeron to Chara. The one-timer. Save, rebound. Lucic scores! 1:22 to go.
This time Lucic in position to get it with the goaltender pulled, the extra player. You can post somebody up right in the slot and still have five guys. Heads up play by David Krejci to find Bergeron to set up the one-timer for Chara. And there's Lucic, an absolute horse here in the third period. Reimer trying to get to that rebound, actually pushes it right back to Lucic. And the Bruins are within one. Boston will use their timeout. 1:22 to go in regulation. This is a young, inexperienced playoff team, the Toronto Maple Leafs. And there's a seed, or maybe something even larger than that, of doubt right now. A minute 22 is a long time. Keep the pressure on if you're Boston. And if you don't think you can go the full 1:22 and you start this portion, this sequence, no the line changes. Know who has who. It has to be seamless. You got to keep fresh bodies. Got to stay on the attack. And everything to the net. You know, Chara turned down that shot last night, Jack.
Not anymore.
He let two fire on that shift. And Lucic's got the second one on the rebound.
Bergeron wins the draw against McClement. Horton touches it back to Chara. David Krejci takes it and turns the corner in a hurry with 1:15 to go in the season. Rask to the Boston bench. The net is empty once again. Chara in the corner. Lucic battles McClement. Chara fires it around. Jágr waiting on the near side. Backhands it in deep. Horton low for Lucic, who rattles Phaneuf with another hit. Horton next to the post. Lucic trying to lug it through the corner. Back to Jágr. Over to Bergeron. Down to the circle to Krejci. 53 seconds to go. Bergeron shots. Goal! Patrice Bergeron ties it. Hearts and Lions. They come from 3-0 in the final 11 minutes to tie game 7.
The will to win has got to be there. You don't want your season to end. You don't want to end it at home. And the Bruins do a terrific job again with the goaltender pulled. No panic in their game. How many goals have the Bruins scored in this series on shots generated from the blue line? A good hard snapshot by Patrice Bergeron. Jara with the assignment to get in on the forecheck and get to the front of the net. Be a big screen. Do not let Reimer have the opportunity to track the puck. But with Jagr on one side, Krejci on the other, and Bergeron working the blue line, Jagr in front of the net. It's a pretty good formula if you make good decisions with the puck and get pucks to the goal.
Towels floating down all over the ice. Delirium at TD Garden. Fans are going to get warned here that the Bruins will get a delay of game penalty.
Bruins to the ice is strictly prohibited. Violators are subject to arrest and prosecution. We thank you for your cooperation.
Not too many people gave a whole lot of hope to the Boston Bruins, who had struggled for offense, down 3 goals with 11 minutes to go. But they have found the elusive other gear.
And a big nod to Milan Lucic, Jack, here in the third period. His determination, no quit in his game. The big fella's been that straight-ahead speed, getting in on the forecheck, carrying pucks wide, making plays, getting to the front of the net. But this is a good battle. Lift of the stick, get the puck to Jagr. That's a big play right there. And he's not going to figure in on the goal. You know, this will be Bergeron's goal in all probability. But Lucic kept the play alive with a lift of the stick where the puck was a 50-50. He's been immense here in the third period. Got the lead to 4-3 with a rebound goal. Set up Horton to make it 4-2. And then on the ice at the critical time to get the tire.
Two goals with the goalie pulled in a seventh game. It's de facto sudden death now. Deafening at TD Garden. Boychuk around the boards, Coleman intercepts, reverses pass, Lupul. Boychuk hops on it, sizzles it up the wing. Marchand on it in a race with Fanouf. Fanouf gets the touch with 27 seconds to go. The faceoff in the Boston end of the ice.
And an opportunity for Kessel to step on the ice right now because of the icing by Boston. Boston has used their timeout, so these bodies will have to have a little gamesmanship here to catch their breath. And don't forget, Fratton had a breakaway. Could have reestablished a two-goal lead. Rask was able to deny him.
Boychuk locks up Kessel. Peverly trickles it around to Chara, who's well over 30 minutes of ice time in the game. Marchand barrels down the left wing, fires it around, a juicy rebound. Peverly, loose puck, couldn't get to it. 10 seconds to go. Reimer has been a rebound-making machine. And the Bruins could not get that one with 10 seconds left. It'll go to sudden death overtime in Game 7.
You know, some players can get lost in the cracks when you have a wild finish like we've had here in regulation. The Bruins in danger of losing the hockey game right here. Fratton on a breakaway, reestablished the lead. Rask stays right with him. Probably doesn't get credit with a save, but he stayed right with the Leafs winger. Then how about that rebound? Unfortunately for Beverly, he couldn't settle that puck down, but I mean, that's not a hard shot by Marchand. Yet the rebound right out in front of the net.
This is as good as it gets, and the Bruins have found that other gear at long last.
So how's your night going so far? Everybody okay?
Oh,
everybody feeling pretty good about themselves? I don't know if I've ever seen anything like that.
I just can't believe what I just witnessed. I mean, this thing felt like it was over and done with, and you're going to sit, we started talking about the Bruins season, and all of a sudden, Lucic just picked up the entire team on his shoulders and said, boys, this ain't done yet.
Julian's talking about Jekyll and Hyde, and just they both showed up in that third period.
I don't know how we're going to make sense of it, but we're going to try. We've got an intermission here between regulation and sudden death overtime. The Bruins have scored three late in the third. The last two with the goaltender pulled, Patrice Bergeron tied it. And believe it or not, they almost won it in the closing 10 seconds. We'll break it all down for you when we come back. This joint is jumping, it's singing, it's rocking, it's doing everything you can think of. The Boston Bruins were down 4-1 late in the third period, and they have come back to tie it and force sudden death overtime in Game 7. Dale Arnold, Barry Peterson, Gord Kluzak. Gordy, we'll let you set up how the Leafs went from a 2-1 lead after two periods to a 4-1 lead. It looked like they were running away with it.
Yeah, and there were people running away from the seats, leaving this building when the Leafs came out at the start of that third period. Took advantage of some loose defensive play in the Bruins zone. Phil Kessel put the Leafs up 3-1, and it looked like the Leafs were off and running. Bruins decimated on the blue line, having trouble in their own zone. The Leafs full of confidence, and then we have another breakdown. The Bruins pressing, they give up a 2-on-1. Kessel fires that hard shot, the rebound goes right to Kadri, and if people weren't heading for the exit when it was 3-1, there are a lot of people heading for the exit when it was 4-1, but not everybody. Quite a few people stayed.
And a whole bunch are trying to get back into the building right now, actually. Well, Nathan Horton began the process of getting the Bruins back into this thing.
Yeah, he really did. But Milan Lucic is the key guy here. He's the guy to me that got the Bruins back in this thing here. It's a great job taking this puck wide. He moves it to the net, controls it all the way around. He sees Horton in front. And he scores a goal on Reimer. You kind of think, okay, well, the Bruins are making this thing close. But a good move right there by Krejci to Lucic. He controls the puck. He goes around the net and sees Horton in front. That makes it 4-2. And we're kind of thinking, okay, you know, the Bruins are getting this close. Isn't that great, right?
I thought Brick made a great point. It was a 4-2 hockey game. Gordy, Matt Fratton had a breakaway. Tuukka Rask held his ground and kept this a two-goal hockey game.
Yeah, it was a critical play here. The Bruins, obviously, defensemen up the ice get caught up. Dougie Hamilton loses control of it, and you have Fratton with a clean breakaway from center ice. He loses control of it, but Tuukka Rask was very much. I mean, he's 3:30 left in the game at that point, and you still don't think they have much chance, but they certainly wouldn't have any chance if that puck goes in the net.
Well, not long after that, the guy who, as Barry said, put this team on his shoulders and lugged it around, Milan Lucic, got them to within one, Gordy.
Yeah, Milan Lucic was an absolute force, and believe me, the Leafs wanted nothing to do with him. He was throwing bodies around. He was standing there in front of the net, and he gets that rebound, and nobody's even trying to move him out of there. Just letting him stand there. Gunnarsson tried to do a little love tap there, but Lucic had mugged Gunnarsson about four times down low, wants nothing to do with him in front of the net, and he's able to get that rebound and put it in.
Yeah, and Rask has been pulled then, so that's the first time they got it, right? So now it's 4-3.
You'll remember earlier this year, Bruins down by a pair of goals to the Rangers, pulled the goaltender, scored twice to tie the game. They did it again tonight, and it was Patrice Bergeron who got the game-tying goal.
Yeah, Bruins call a timeout, get a chance to pull the goaltender again. They put Chara down in front. Watch the big body in front. Reimer can't see. The Bruins do a good job. Lucic again, winning a one-on-one battle down low, gets it to Jágr.
moves it around Bergeron to Krejci, back to Bergeron, and what a snapshot. But look at Chara in front, and this place goes crazy. Again, the Bruins with six guys on the ice. It is tied 4-4, and we can't believe what we just witnessed.
The shadow of Mount Chara was a little too much for James Reimer to see around.
Yeah, Reimer's looking. Look, he can't find it. He said, where is it? Chara's a 6'9 body. He says, you're not going to see this thing. And boy, what a great wrist shot by Patrice Bergeron.
You could just see the Leafs. They were almost paralyzed. To use an old Derek Sanderson line, it was knee-deep and anesthetic. That's what they were right there.
4-4 at the end of regulation. The Bruins have a 30-26 shots on goal advantage. Look at the face-off circle advantage for Boston. And now they've taken the lead in scoring chances as well. For a lot of this night, it didn't seem to be going the Bruins' way. A big comeback in the third period. Sean Thornton downstairs talking with Nauko.
Well, it took some work, Sean, but the team is back in this one. How does it speak to the will of your guys?
That was exciting. Great job. I mean, we never gave up. Now we gave ourselves a chance for, you know, one more period, and hopefully we can capitalize. We worked this hard to get back into it. Now we got to go take it. So the season's on the line here.
How tremendous has Milan Lucic been? He's been a part of all of the goals, but most importantly, of course, the critical game-tying goal.
Yeah, that I like the one that Horty scored. I mean, Lucic pretty much did all the legwork there. Had his feet moving, strong on the puck, and found Horty on the back door. I think when the big boy's moving, he can be unstoppable. So we'll need some more of that from him in this period.
What will be the talk like in the room going into OT here?
I'll tell you after.
Sounds good. Good luck here in overtime. Thank you, Sean.
Thanks, Nauko.
Dale.
Well, as exciting as things were, believe it or not, they almost had a chance to win this thing. That big rebound for Rich Peverly right there. Can you imagine what the scene in Toronto would have been? We'll be back with more in just a moment. We're heading for overtime. Game 7 at the Garden. A little bit later on, we might have a thing or two to talk about on Nesson Daily, a special Game 7 playoff edition. Nesson Daily comes to you from here at the Garden a little bit later on. Here at the TD Garden, where we are tied at 4 at the end of regulation. This is the 17th overtime in the first round. That is a Stanley Cup playoffs record.
Yeah, right now Toronto's got to be reeling in that dressing room. We can't believe what we witnessed. They probably can't believe what just happened to them.
Yeah, but it seems like the pressure's gone right back on the Toronto Maple Leafs. To squander that kind of lead would be epic pain in Toronto. Tremendous pressure on the Leafs. On the other hand, the Bruins are decimated on the blue line, and it's going to be tough in overtime.
I have no idea when we'll be done, but when we are, we'll be back here. I got a feeling that this joint is still going to be rocking when we come back after the break. Jack Edwards and Andy Brickley take you to overtime coming up next.
Comeback.
Well, it started with Milan Lucic. Powerful skater to the outside. Uses the net. Makes a play to Horton out in the slot area. Lucic again able to get to the rebound of the drive from the point. That was what the goaltender pulled. That got it to 4-3. Bruins able to get the goaltender out because they win the faceoff. After they cut it to 4-3, Chara's assignment. You're so used to seeing him out the blue line, but in this case, they designed the fact to get him to the front of the net. They worked the high umbrella and the snapshot by Bergeron. Reimer not able to pick it up. What a finish to regulation, Jack. The will to win. Both these clubs, but more importantly, the Bruins, who found themselves down 4-1.
Original six teams. There was a piece of confetti that was floating down on the ice, and somebody threw a water bottle off the Boston bench to try to get the referee's attention. And they did. Next goal wins the series. Clark MacArthur over the line. The snapshot stick saved by Rask. MacArthur in the corner.
Brings it back to Grabowski, shovels it down low. Kurlevic couldn't get the backhand on goal. Krejci shoves the puck up the wall. Milan Lucic runs into Fanuf's check. The puck rolls deep. Gunnarsson takes it. Loose puck comes up the slot. Kurlevic tips it for MacArthur. MacArthur pulls up short of the hash marks and dumps it in deep. Let's go, Bruins, the champ. Barkowski angles it and it comes right to the post. Reimer has to cover.
Well, you want to attack Toronto early and often here in this overtime, not irresponsibly, without a good third man in the offensive zone, but the way that regulation ended with the tremendous pressure by Boston, there's got to be, again, to use that phrase, some kind of doubt in these Leafs. I know they were playing loose and free, the underdog, nothing to lose in this tremendous comeback, being down 3-1 in games. But everything to the net right now if you're the Bruins.
Phil Kessel is on the ice. James Van Riemsdyk and Jay McClinic, the other forwards. Chara tips the puck loose for Bergeron, who tied the game. Jágr in the corner, who had an assist in the three-goal comeback. Jágr spins away from McClinic. Jágr right across the goal mouth. Gardner catches it on his forehand. Van Riemsdyk to McClinic and in deep. Chara and Kessel. Kessel won't challenge. Chara around. Pass Marchand. Franzen off of Jager's legs. Jágr wants to change up.
You got to be careful if you're Jágr coming out from behind the net. If you're not going to use your points, you can't have Chara itching in.
Marchand attempting to saucer it over to Sagan. Boychuk fires the puck in deep. Sagan attacks Franzen. Franzen up to the attacking line to Kessel. Kessel, the shot goes over the top. He got a ton on that. Van Riemsdyk, Kessel behind the Boston goal. Kadri, the one-timer, Lupo stick, saved by Rask. Lupo back to the goal. Lupo to the backhand, saved by Rask. The puck goes loose below the circle. Sagan backhands the puck. Second chance, gets it up the head to Rich Peverly. Peverly fires it into a burn stick. The puck pops loose. Lupo looks north and south. It's beyond Fratton's reach. All the way around. McQuaid on contact. It's icing. Tuukka Rask, gigantic in sudden death.
Lupo fresh off the bench. He gets into that high slot area. Able to take a one-timer. Low blocker side. Rask tracked it well, moved well, positioned well. Big time stop.
Colborne and Krejci on the faceoff. Krejci wins it, but Colborne's big reach takes it away from Lucic. McQuaid indirect. Horton the quick pivot. Lucic getting broken down by Colborne's pressure. Skids into the Zamboni doors. The crowd roaring. Colborne runs into Horton. Horton takes the puck away, nudges to Krejci. Krejci fires cross ice. Chara keeps it on the line, onside. Horton back of the goal. Horton to Chara, the one-timer, tipped, and it goes off the end glass. Krejci was parked in front. Krejci tries to dribble it in front. Colborne skates it north and south. Marchand reached out to get a piece of Fratton, and the puck went into the Toronto bench, and I thought that Marchand might be a little fortunate not to get called for a leg check there.
Well, McQuaid was up in the offensive zone. I think David Krejci was looking for him on that backhand feed when he doesn't get much on it. Now Marchand's the guy that's got to defend. And Marchand has to make a decision. Do I try to stand up? And he got enough of the puck to get it up over the boards to prevent any kind of a rush by the Leafs.
Bergeron, Marchand, Boychuk, and Barkowski. Jágr to Boychuk. Saved by Reimer, and there's no rebound. And Fanuf just falls flat on top of Bergeron in the slot.
Well, they give Jágr the blue line. They back off. They allow him to carry it in. And now the Bruins with good gaps. Johnny Boychuk's able to get up. Bergeron's trying to work the front of the net, getting Reimer's sight, line of sight. But Reimer able to track it. But another offensive zone faceoff for Boston.
It's a tunnel of noise at TD Garden. And James Reimer is stuck in it. Phaneuf runs into Bergeron's check and goes spilling across the red line. Kulinen on the forecheck. Grabowski to Kulinen. Drops it off to Gardner, the shot. And it ricochets into the corner. Grabowski picks it up, swivels toward the front. Bergeron's there. Marchand has Yager on the right. Can't stick handle around Franzen. Boychuk steps up and drills Kulinen. Marchand redirects the bouncer. Sagan going after Gardner. Gardner has body position. Gets it through Marchand. Here comes Matt Fratton. Fratton closes. Fires well wide glove side. Kelly just out of the ice. Here's Tyler Sagan. He's got Peverly out high. The shot goes off Gardner's stick up into the protective netting. The faceoff in the Toronto zone.
Well, some mistakes of fatigue, both physical and mental. Boston really an unforced turnover on a simple breakout. Trying to go D to D and up to the wing, and that caused some problems. Gardner gets a chance. And then Marchand trying to beat somebody one-on-one in the neutral zone before the red line. And that's just not a smart play at this point. It's a turnover in a dangerous area.
The faceoff. Hamilton snapshot tipped in front and it goes into the protective netting. The faceoff will be outside as it came off of Sagan's stick, I believe.
Well, faceoff win. The Bruins have been dominant the faceoff circle. They're a good faceoff team. Snapshot by Hamilton, the redirect by Sagan. Get a good look at it up over the glass. And that's why that faceoff's in the neutral zone.
With Chara and Hamilton, the deep pair, Beverly. Hamilton hard around into the zone. Kelly pops it in deep. Colborne under pressure from Beverly. Beverly bounces off. Sagan steals the puck. Sagan shot saved by Ryman Oliva.
Fundamentals, win the draw in the neutral zone. That's what Beverly does. The hard wrap around by Hamilton. The good pushback down in the corner by Kelly. Beverly. Get in on the forecheck, and then the support from Sagan on the net swing, and then attack the goal. Basic fundamentals that are generally productive in overtime games.
Horton, Boychuk, and McQuaid. McClement to take the draw for Toronto. Lucic wins it back. McQuaid snapshot off Lupo's legs. Fratton going for the puck. Rask way out, steers it behind the goal to safety. Krejci into the neutral zone. Lucic battling against Cody Franzen, who scored two goals for Toronto to get the Leafs from 0-1 down to 2-1 up. Jake Gardner. Cody Franzen loops it into Boychuk's corner. The tap to McQuaid. Van Riemsdyk seals it off along the boards. McQuaid squirts it back to the near side. Boychuk takes the hit from Kadri to send it through the neutral zone. Gardner back up in front of the penalty bench. Lucic gloves the puck down. A little wiggle of a move to gain the zone. Finds Horton. Horton's drive gets deflected wide. Krejci catches it on the backhand. Gives it to Horton coming out of the corner. Horton to Chara. Quickly to Krejci on the half boards. He tosses the backhand to Lucic in deep against Gardner. Gardner loses his stick. Lucic turns to the hash marks. Fires off Gardner's skate after Gardner had recovered the stick. Horton spins Gardner around. Franzen's there. Hard off the boards. Chara pinches up against Kessel and Hamilton recovers the puck. Dougie Hamilton finds Bergeron over the line. Bergeron going past the goal. Sagan sets up in front. Now Sagan at the post on the cycle. Right off of Reimer. The stick save. Boychuk's drive rattles around in front. Marchand to Bergeron. The drive save. Rebound is loose. Sagan kicks it loose. Bergeron scores!
Patrice Bergeron tied the game late in regulation, and he wins it here in overtime. That line of his, much maligned throughout this series for their lack of production, Marchand and Sagan in particular, not so much Bergeron. And Bergeron had the answer tonight when the Bruins needed him most.
It may not have been their finest hour, but for 16 minutes and 47 seconds, four unanswered goals will live in Boston Bruins history forever. I doubt we'll ever see the likes of this again, Brick.
And you wanted this game to end early in overtime, Jack. Reason being, the doubt that was planted in the Toronto Maple Leafs with the Bruins scoring a pair of goals with their goaltender pulled, plus the fact of the three games in four nights, not friendly to Boston this year, whether you take into account regular season statistics or not. And no Ferentz, no Redden. More importantly, no Seidenberg tonight. You got Hamilton playing minutes, Bartkowski playing minutes back there for you. You have some right-handed shots playing the offside on the defensive side. Something that generally doesn't work well with this group. So you wanted this thing to end as early as possible in overtime. And Bergeron is able to send the Bruins on with the next round.
Before every game seven, people always say, well, what do you think? What do you think? And there were hundreds of thousands of predictions around New England and Ontario today. Nobody picked it this way. Sagan and Marchand. Zdeno Chara is at ice level with Nalko Funayama.
See, how does it speak to the will of the team to come back from being down 4-1 to win this one in overtime?
I can't hear what you're saying.
How does it speak to the will of the team to come back from being 4-1 down?
Yeah, it means a lot to us. Being down 4-1, it wasn't easy, especially on the mental part of our bodies, but it positive and saying let's get the next one, and after that the next one, and before you knew we were able to tie the game, and we carried that momentum into the overtime.
What was the talk like in the room at overtime, before overtime? What was the talk like in the room going into overtime?
Not much. I mean, we were trying to get rest, and obviously we were just focusing on the next 20 minutes.
Thank you. Tickets for round two, Eastern Conference semifinals against the New York Rangers, who were 4-0 winners against the Washington Caps tonight, will go on sale 45 minutes after the conclusion of the game. Brick, this is the end of our play-by-play rights, but who has more fun than us at the end?
And what a way to go out, I'll tell you. I mean, just a nice rotation. This line back together here in overtime. Jágr had played a lot on the right side with Bergeron tonight, but it's Sagan and his young legs out there with the young legs of Marchand. They get the cycle game going. They open up that slot area in a good triangle. Good battle by Sagan to try to keep this play alive. The Leafs hand the puck right back to Bergeron, and he did not miss.
Mar- Marchand and Sagan at the receiving end of a great deal of due criticism in this series. But when it counted the most, the other gear you've been talking about since January finally showed up in the transmission.
Yeah, and you know, just what an effort by Milan Lucic, David Krejci, Nathan Horton. That line was immense in this series, and it allowed some time. I mean, it's late in the series, but enough time for the Bergeron line to have an effect, have an impact, and it comes at the perfect time. But Patrice Bergeron, you know, there's just, is there a better professional in the National Hockey League? I don't think so.
Let's hear from him with Nalco.
Third time is a charm. You guys finally closed this thing out. Patrice, what did it take tonight?
I think it was a great team effort. Obviously, we didn't get the way we wanted it in the second period and obviously in the third. But at the end, when we found a way, we found our legs, we found the energy, and we got the goals that we needed to come out on top and move on to the second round.
We know you're a clutch player. Take us through your goal.
Yeah, I mean, it was a great play by our line. You know, it was nice to see that and moving our feet, moving the puck, and finally getting a bounce. And, you know, I knew the puck was probably going to bounce on that back door because it did that a couple times in the series. And finally, I got lucky to go right on my stick, so I had to put it in.
You create your own luck. Congratulations on the win here today. Thank you, Patrice.
All right, thank you, guys.
Jack?
Nalco, thank you. We will go for quite a while on our postgame show. Dale Arnold is the party master downstairs. Dale, they bared their souls, they bared their hearts, and Toronto poked the bear and didn't get away with it.
Jack, someday your neighbor is going to tell you that he was one of the 952,000 people who were here tonight to see the comeback. A young lady who played hockey at UMass just tweeted, "I wonder if I'll be this happy on my wedding day." We'll talk all about it after the game. Bruins take the series, one of the most remarkable comebacks you'll ever see. Claude Julien will go one-on-one with Nalco. We'll get reaction from a jubilant Bruins dressing room. Barry Peterson, Gord Kluzak, and I here for Ace Ticket Bruins Overtime Live coming up next.
Hello out there, we're on the air, it's hockey night tonight. Tension grows, the whistle blows, and the puck goes down the ice. The goalie jumps and the players bump and the fans all go insane. Someone roars, Bobby scores at the good old hockey game. Oh, the good old hockey game is the best game you can name. And the best game you can name.
Called simply the comeback. It was a Game 7 comeback, a Game 7 third period comeback. The Bruins have won Game 7 in sudden death overtime. They are headed for the Eastern Conference semifinals to take on the New York Rangers, a series that will likely begin on Thursday, but we'll get into all of that a little bit later on. Dale Arnold, Barry Peterson, Gord Kluzak here. I've said it about four times. I'll say it again. I've never seen anything like it.
I never have. You've been around this game a long time. We've seen a lot of big playoffs games. This is Game 7. It's 4-1 late in the third, and it doesn't feel good. And then all of a sudden, the floodgates open, and boy, Lucic put the boys on his shoulders. Big saves by Rask, and they come right back. Huh?
Yeah, you know, you just can't help but think of some of those shifts that Milan Lucic put in when it was down 4-1. And it looked like things were over, but he just kept barreling in there, making things go. He refused to give up. And And he kind of brought the rest of the team right along with him. It was an extraordinary thing to see.
The Bruins were kind of up against it just on a couple of fronts here to go into the game. Andrew Ferentz was out, was seen in a walking boot before the game. Wade Redden was a late scratch. And then 37 seconds into the first period, they lose their second best defense.
Yeah, you could just see his knee right there. As he pitches in, he's trying to be aggressive along the wall. Look at his leg, just gets kind of whipped around there. And he went down off the bench and went down and sat in there. And he kind of sat around Gordy for the whole bit of the first period. We kind of weren't sure what was going to happen. But then look at the minutes. Chara and Boychuk. And give young Matt Barkowski a lot of credit getting those 24 minutes. But the remaining five did a great job under difficult circumstances.
They did. I mean, Dougie Hamilton, Adam McQuaid, you had three right-handed shots all of a sudden. You had all these left-handed defensemen going out of the lineup. And it had to be so difficult for those guys to not only play that many minutes, play under that kind of pressure, and play the off side if you're the right-handed defenseman. And it didn't look very good for the Bruins. I just couldn't imagine a formula that they would be able to come back and win this game.
Well, that meant a lot of minutes for Dougie Hamilton, and as you saw, for Matt Bartkowski. You know, if you're going to score your first NHL goal, what the heck? Why not do it in Game 7 of the playoffs, Gordy?
Yeah, it was a good play again. Milan Lucic involved in the forecheck here, and Franson would come back and score a couple of goals for the Leafs. He's guilty of a giveaway deep in their zone here. Tries to make it behind, between the legs, backhand pass. David Krejci just drives to the front of the net. Bartkowski waits very calmly for Krejci to get in a position to provide a screen, and then fires a shot short side.
Well, if you had asked me about halfway through the third period who the player of the game was, I would have told you Cody Franson. He had the next two goals in the game, one of them on the power play to put Toronto in front.
Yeah, he had a great first half of the hockey game despite that giveaway there. But he did a good job on the power play here. The Leafs moving around the outside to Kessel, get it back to Phaneuf at the point, and they crash. Van Riemsdyk is in front doing what he does. You see Franson sneaking in the back door. He's able to get a power play goal that ties things up. But Van Riemsdyk, again, he had a good series. He was very physically involved in front of the net, and Franson did a good job here. You're going to see them dump the puck in. Bruins get caught a little flat-footed. They're a little tired, long shift. Hamilton takes the body, but watch the traffic in front here as they move this thing back to Franson. He lets a rocket go, and Rask has no idea where it is. You see Grabowski in front. You see Chara in front, and that made it 2-1.
It was 2-1 at the end of two periods of play, and the Bruins, as we said, were kind of up against it from a personnel perspective. Then you go into the third period, Gordy, and you get goals from Kessel and Kadri, and it looks like an insurmountable 4-1 mountain to climb.
Yeah, it was what you would expect. The real skilled guys in the Toronto Maple Leafs having plenty of room to operate out there. The Bruins depleted on the blue line, and the Leafs taking full advantage of that. Look at the room they have to operate in their zone. Kessel gets the loose puck in behind the Bruins defense, and it's 3-1, and it looks like the Leafs are very much in control at this point. Maybe the game's not over yet, but this is where you think it's over. The Leafs come up, Kessel shoots the hard shot, Kadri finds the rebound, it's 4-1. I mean, that's when people start to leave, and this thing is over. There's no way the Bruins could come back and win it. And boy, oh boy, that story was yet to be written.
Yeah, Bozak went down. Remember, they weren't sure how they're going to work out. Kadri, who'd struggled the most of that series, all of a sudden he jumps in between Van Riemsdyk and Kessel, and that line was very effective.
Well, the best line for the Bruins throughout this entire series was Krejci, Horton, and Lucic, so it kind of, it almost seemed apropos that it would be one of those guys, and it was Nathan Horton who began the comeback for the Bruins in the third.
Yeah, he started it, but we're going to see Lucic all of a sudden. He's the guy that takes over here. We talked about this earlier. He's the guy that just said, come on, jump on the back. It was a great job of getting in front to Nathan Horton. Okay, and everyone says, okay, there's 10:42 left. It's 4-2. We're kind of making this respectable, but then all of a sudden, Gordy, they keep moving it around.
Yeah, empty net now, and the Bruins, look at the amount of space the Leafs are giving. Milan Lucic standing in front of the net, a Leafs defenseman nowhere near him. And now it's 4-3, and things are really starting to get interesting.
Yeah, they'll call a timeout, and all of a sudden you get an extra attacker still out there. It's 6-on-4. Get the puck back to Jagr. Move it around. Krejci back to Bergeron. And look at Big Chara in front. Reimer can't see it. We got ourselves a tie hockey game on a 6-on-4 with Chara in front. We just can't believe what we just witnessed.
The spectacular job that Chara did setting the screen, that the Bruins did keeping possession. Look, let's be honest. As you heard Jack say late after the overtime game winner, that line of Bergeron and Marchand and Sagan took some heat in this entire series and probably deserved it. But boy, when they needed a guy to come up big, Patrice Bergeron did.
Yeah, Patrice Bergeron in particular. I think he's had a good series. I don't think he had a couple of chances where he probably wished he had scored, but he didn't miss the last two chances in this game. And just with the Leafs, this was the common theme. They were back on their heels. They stopped skating. The Bruins were just buzzing around.
down, jumping on the loose pucks, beating them to the loose pucks. Tyler Seguin with some great work in front of the net, and Patrice Bergeron sort of sensing that puck might pop out to the right-hand side there, and he wasn't going to miss that open net this time with Reimer down and out, but some great work by Tyler Seguin in front of that net. That little footwork made all the difference and caused the turnover.
Well, when you score the tying goal late in regulation with the goaltender pulled and the overtime goal to win it in Game 7, yeah, you're our Subaru Dealers of New England star of the game. Look, for the entire series, Patrice Bergeron would probably tell you his production wasn't what he wanted, but what a game tonight. Yeah. Two goals, an assist, and a plus three.
Yeah, and you can't just look at his point total, of course. He does so much on the faceoffs, penalty killer, he's a leader. Krejci line, they had done it for them all series. Lucic, we got them back in, but boy, those two big goals by Bergeron late. You know, ties things up, then you win in the overtime, and it was very appropriate. Here's a guy that, like Brickett said, one of the best pros in the National Hockey League, and all of a sudden, he's the hero.
Yeah, you know, he's just going to go out there and grind and grind. He's never going to get down on himself and things like that. He's not going to feel sorry for himself. He's going to keep working and working and working, and ultimately was successful, incredibly successful in getting it done. But I really think it's Bergeron and Lucic. They're the co-stars of this game, because without Lucic's work, Bergeron would never have had the opportunity to do what he did at the end.
And we're talking about the Bruins showing all that excitement. What do you think is going on in the Leafs dressing room right now?
Huh? It has got to be something, huh?
Oh, my goodness. They had the game under control. Reimer was playing so well, and then all of a sudden it just caved right in.
Well, they just stopped skating. Yep. They just totally, they collapsed back. The Bruins just, and you know, a lot of it, I think, started when Lucci started hammering
Took the body down.
You know, and the Leafs are going, what's going on here? And they just kept collapsing and collapsing until they couldn't collapse anymore, and then the Bruins started filling the net, and then it was, it had to be some serious, serious soul-searching in Toronto's locker room after the in the overtime, and man, oh man, they came out just as tentative as they had been at the end of the
third period. Lucic is getting physical out there, and he's banging you and I around up here. It's crazy.
Hey, Nesson, back there at the studio, show us that Maple Leaf Plaza now, will you? We were seeing it earlier in the night. I've been so happy to say this all night long. Tickets are available right now for the Eastern Conference semifinal, the Bruins and the New York Rangers, another Original Six matchup. If you're interested, and somehow I think you might be, you can visit aceticket.com right now. Well, we know the eight teams remaining in the Stanley Cup playoffs. We know the four matchups that are left in the East and the West. Well, I guess that game isn't quite over, but it's close. And the score indicates that it's close as well. And that's what it was like at the Fours earlier tonight. Sort of like what it looked like up here where we were sitting as well. When we come back in just a little bit, Nauko will go one-on-one with Claude Julien. Somehow numbers and words on a page don't quite do this one justice as we look at the game summary. The Bruins beat the Toronto Maple Leafs 5-4 in sudden death overtime in Game 7. They outshoot the Leafs 35-28. Face-off circle domination. Scoring chances favored the Bruins as well. What it means is that the Bruins move on to the Eastern Conference semifinals to face likely the New York Rangers. After the game, Bruins head coach Claude Julien went one-on-one with Nauko Funayama.
Coach, your team was down 4-1. What did you see kick in at that point?
Well, obviously desperation, and you know, we talked about our team being a Jekyll and Hyde hockey club, and I told them after the game they didn't disappoint me. They showed that same thing in just one game where we saw the worst of our team and we saw the best of our team. So at least they saved the best for last and gave us a chance to win a hockey game.
What was the talk like? What was the sentiment like in the locker room going into overtime?
Well, pretty confident. I think you know, when you score the three goals in the last 8 minutes and create an overtime, especially with the goaltender pulled for two. You know, guys are really confident, and you know, when you do something like that, you want to finish the job properly. So there was a lot of confidence in the room, and even like in the third period, we gave up a couple of quick goals, which seemed to push us out of the game. But the guys remained calm instead of frustrated, and then we worked ourselves back into it.
A couple of your big players coming up very big tonight, but specifically, can you talk about the play of Milan Lucic and Patrice Bergeron?
Yeah, those two guys were obviously big, and you know, Milan scored that goal last night by having a good net front presence tonight again. You know, he told me before the game that he felt pretty good. You know, I was asking players about, you know, the travel and everything else, how they felt, and our guys felt pretty good. So, you know, we were hoping it was going to be a blessing in disguise to maybe get an early rest and come back here in the morning. So, you know, our guys seem to have pretty good legs, but Bergie and also Lucha are big heroes for us tonight.
What did you take and what do you learn from this series here?
Well, you know, we got to give credit to the other team. Like, I know most of the time coaches want to do that out of politeness, but this isn't out of politeness. It's really meaningful, and I thought they played a real heck of a series and gave us a run for our money. And, you know, for a team that was out of playoffs for so many years, they made some huge strides, and they deserve a lot of credit. But for our team, you know, we have to hopefully use this momentum and kind of get our team stabilized and play more of a 60-minute steady effort versus the Jekyll and Hyde or the up and downs of a hockey game.
And finally, a couple of your young defensemen had to kind of grow up pretty quickly in this game today, taking some responsibility.
Yeah, they did. You know, Reds couldn't go tonight, and then we lost Seidenberg after the first or in the first period. So those young guys had to step in and do a big job for us. And what better way to earn some experience in playing a lot in Game 7? And, you know, Bartkowski scoring that big first goal, it was huge for his confidence and then for us to see that from him. But both those young guys handled themselves very well.
Congratulations on the series win. Thank you, Coach.
Thanks, Uncle.
Dale?
I would reserve my comments towards officiating. Obviously, the playoffs are a different breed, and I don't and truly believe that every little thing should be called in the playoffs, but I think if there is things that are over the top or on the fine line of being over-aggressive, that's my belief. You know, the chintzy little push on the hands or something like that, little hook on the hip. To me, it's playoffs are about competing and let the players decide. And that's really all I've got to comment on the officiating.
Randy.
Bob's Discount Furniture, save of the game, Tuukka Rask, and it comes in overtime. Joffrey Lupul with the drive may have actually caught a piece of Matt Barkowski's stick, but Tuukka Rask flashed out the right pad, made the stop, and kept the Bruins alive in sudden death overtime. That one right there, the save of the game from goaltender Tuukka Rask. The Bruins move on. They head for the Eastern Conference Finals, and Bruins Nation is very, very happy. When we come back, we'll hear from the guy who scored the overtime game winner, Patrice Bergeron. Pretty excited crowd outside the TD Garden, and they should be because their team is advancing to the Eastern Conference semifinals. Tickets for home games 1, 2, and 3 of the Eastern Conference semifinal will go on sale tonight at approximately 10:45 p.m. It is the Bruins against the New York Rangers. Purchase your tickets by visiting bostonbruins.com or through the Bruins mobile app starting at approximately 10:45. After the game, the guy who scored the tying goal in regulation, the winning goal in overtime, Patrice Bergeron from the Bruins dressing room.
What's it like to score the game winner?
Yeah, for sure. It was one of the crazy ones I've been part of. We stayed resilient. I guess that's what I can say is we found a way, and not necessarily the way we would have liked to play the whole game, but like I said, we showed some character coming back in the game, and we found a way in overtime. We had the momentum, I thought, and her legs were back, and felt good.
Patrice, Red Lewis, 7 News. Your line had come under some scrutiny in this series. I guess you were just saving your two goals for when you really needed them.
Yeah, no, I wasn't, but. You know what? I have high expectations of myself, and I'm probably my hardest critic. So whatever pressure is outside of me, or I don't really worry about it because I know I'm putting higher expectations than anyone else. So it's about finding a way and showing some character, and I thought we did that tonight. And we had to. Everyone's got to step up in the playoffs, and tonight was my turn. I had to do it for my teammates.
Matt Kalman, thebruinsblog.net. Can you point to one thing as the turning point where you guys finally started to play the way you wanted to?
I thought we had some good looks. You know, we had some good chances. We couldn't get those rebounds. And I think right away when they scored the fourth goal and we got that or second goal, I thought you guys stayed positive even though we were down by three, and we said we could do it. And then that big goal from that line there, the second goal was huge for us and got us some momentum, and we kept pushing at it, and we found a way with the extra man.
Well, you already saw Patrice Bergeron wearing that U.S. Army Rangers player of the game jacket as he talked to the media. That means that we'll give the final word on this one to the goaltender, the guy who won it for the Bruins, Tuukka Rask.
We weren't bouncing on the rebounds, and you know, that's what you have to do to score goals, and we just did that and paid off.
Is that the best contact you've ever been a part of, considering how many goals you scored in such a short amount of time?
It has to be. In a game seven, too. It has to be, yeah.
Do you get the chills when that's going on?
No, not chills. I think my hearing was about to. You know, I was going to go deaf there. It was so loud, man. It was something what you don't experience too often in hockey. And, you know, it was just fantastic.
And the music sounded a little louder than it usually does with Tyler Anthony.
Here?
Yeah.
I didn't see him. I was out there doing that early in the camp. I didn't see him. He probably was.
The sentiment in the room going into overtime was pretty good.
Yeah, everybody was, you know, vocal, and we were just saying keep the momentum going and, you know, keep shooting the puck. I was just, you know, trying to stay calm, and I knew I had to make a save or two again to keep it tied, and then Bergie comes up big, shockingly.
How was the confidence level in general?
I'm not a sadist, but this is the shot I wanted to see. Maple Leafs square. A little subdued at the end of the game, as they've seen their Toronto Maple Leafs fall apart completely in the third period. Up 4-1, they gave up the 3-goal lead. Whoops, folks are a little upset, as Patrice Bergeron provided the game winner. We've got lots more post-game coverage coming up right after this.
It's been said that at times teams play at their very best when they get a whiff of their mortality. That was no whiff. That absolutely stunk, and they could see the Grim Reaper coming toward him with a nasty look on his face. An epic comeback, but the Bruins remembered to play fundamental hockey while they were coming back and winning this.
Yeah, and getting back to those fundamentals really paid off for them. And, you know, straight ahead, straight lines, attack your opponent, bring your skating game, get to the front of the net, you know, everything with a purpose. And I guess that sense of their mortality really brought out their will to win in this hockey game. And there were a number of highlights that we could highlight that really show what the Bruins were able to do in terms of that fundamental game. And all you got to do is really is concentrate on Patrice Bergeron. Gets open in the middle of the neutral zone. Gives Dougie Hamilton a perfect target. Now you got entry in the offensive zone. And what do you want to do when you get in the offensive zone? We talk about it all the time. Create those triangles. Try to create series of two-on-ones. And when this line, the Bergeron line, plays their best, they do a lot of this. That cycle game, they create, they rotate. Now you don't know if you're in man-on-man or in zone coverage. Again, Bergeron, he sees the pinch down by Boychuk. What's he got to do? I got to protect. I'm one of the best defensive players in the game that also has an offensive flair. Rotate back. Back to the right point. The minute Boychuk starts to back out, now where do I go? I get to that high slot. Again, the cycle game, the triangles, and all of a sudden, Bergeron finds that loose puck after good pressure by Marchand and Sagan. There's your OT winner in a game where the Bruins were down 4-1 with less than 10 to go in regulation.
You know, when we came on the air for our game coverage on the 1st of May, we said that sometime in the next 13 days, one of these two teams would finally impose its will on the other and push it to a break point. Who could have predicted that it would have come in this fashion, with the Bruins rallying from that far down that late and Bergeron writing his name into the annals of Boston Bruins history with the series winner?
Well, as Jack just said, unfortunately, our play-by-play coverage is now done for the Stanley Cup playoffs, but the quest for the Cup continues. We will have complete pre- and post-game coverage for every single game right here on NESN. We hope you'll continue to join us. Quest for the Cup is brought to you by Xfinity. The fans are pretty happy outside, and they were happy inside. When we come back, we'll take a look back at an unbelievable Game 7.
Chuck's drive rattles around in front. Marchand to Bergeron, the drive save, rebound is loose. Sagan kicks it loose. Bergeron scores! Patrice Bergeron with the point of the dagger in their throats. They rip it out of Toronto's hands and kill the beast. The Boston Bruins have won it after being 3-0 in the third.
The guy who made made that call. Jack Edwards joins us in studio right now. Maybe the most optimistic person I know, but come on. Even you, down 4-1 in the third, you weren't thinking this was going to happen.
We're about 3 minutes from loading the postmortem in. You know, it's like, all right, what are we going to do with this team? But, hey, we can put it off for a while, maybe a long while. I've never experienced anything like that. I mean, none of us has. That's just...
No, we talked about with Brick. How about the effort of Milan Lucic? It just looked like he took over. He told the guys, jump on the shoulders, and let's get it going.
And isn't that why he is the franchise-type player that he is for these Bruins? You know, there's so much of the subject during the season was, wow, look at what this guy's salary is and what it's going to be and how long it's going to be there. But that's because what they see in Lucic is that, what we saw on the ice tonight. And that's why he is part of the inside core of this team, because he can do what... I mean, how many players have you ever seen in the National Hockey League do that kind of a thing to that kind of a game? And that thing in a series, just an astounding turnaround.
You know, a guy we haven't really talked about, but obviously he was the key part of this series, was David Krejci. I mean, he was immense. And when the rest of the team wasn't going, even at shift to shift, he was the guy that was the most consistent. And even tonight, he was there again. So he had just had a spectacular series.
Yeah, and big game player. I mean, how good is this guy's resume at this point, you know? And Krejci is a guy whose point per game average goes up in the playoffs. When he's playing against better defensemen, when he's playing against better systems, when the games mean the most, when you're measured, this is what you're going to be measured on at the end of your career. And David Krejci is... you know, again, he's rising to the occasion.
As a play-by-play announcer, it's easy when you're calling the game-winning goal in overtime to know that's a key moment. During the course of the game, there are other subtle moments that you don't realize are key. The Matt Fratton breakaway, when it was a two-goal game, that could have been one of the key moments of the hockey game.
Yeah, Tuukka Rask made some incredible saves in this game, and it could have been really one-sided. Toronto was feeling it after the 3-1 goal. You could feel that typical Toronto surge, and one got the sense of kind of, uh-oh. And Rask, you know, he held his ground. He did a beautiful job. Fratton is a highly skilled player. This is a guy who led the NCAA in scoring in North Dakota. And you know, if not for the problems that he had off the ice his junior year, probably would have won the Hobie. And he was a real threat. I think I said something like he's a skilled scorer or something. First thing that went into my head was, oh, no, not him.
You know, at first I wasn't sure if it rolled off his stick, but I think Tuukka still got a piece of it.
Yeah, he did. He did. I'm sure it wasn't exactly the way Fratton wanted it to go, but he got it close enough. And Rask came out and denied him also. You know, and that's the thing about Tuukka Rask. He's not that flailing, kinetic goalie that we so often see who makes the highlight reels, but he gives the shooter so little and stays so calm in a situation where you're thinking, well, this is the end of the season right here.
Now, for as excited as we are, how about the city of Toronto and the hockey mecca? As you know, what's going to happen up there the next couple of weeks?
You know, I mean, we described them as the pre-04 Red Sox for a long time. Well, now, I mean, what a perfect fit. Can you believe that happened to them? And you got to say this for Toronto. In almost every first-round series, there is a point of nastiness where it really gets personal between the cities. And it almost got to that point with the Toronto stronger sign. But so many people from Toronto had so much class and condemned it and saw it for what it was. And it really was just hockey games. And it was great. And let me jam this in, by the way, because it's been kind of a popular sport to diss the Bruins. This is their seventh series win since 2009. That's tied for the most in the National Hockey League. This is a league in which parity reigns. There have been 9 consecutive different Stanley Cup champions. Nobody's repeated over the last 9 seasons that have been played in the NHL. There's only one team in the NHL that has made the second round 4 years out of 5. It's the team that plays on that ice right down there. And, you know, it seems that they ought to do better. That's how good the NHL is. The Bruins, over the course of the last 5 years, one easily could make the argument that they are the best team over that 5-year period. Yet we pull our hair out over these guys almost every season.
Well, you see their character in that type of situation. Down 4-1, you didn't see guys sort of banging sticks and sort of getting giving each other nasty looks. They just hung in there together. Tuca was in front, and they came back.
You gave me a nasty look at 4-1. I mean, come on.
Nobody's ever going to leave early again.
No,
Jack
absolutely.
Will also be part of our coverage as we continue on throughout the course of the playoffs. That wraps up this edition of Nesson Daily, but don't go anywhere, because we're coming right back on a night that Bruins fans will remember forever.